fire marshal, the fire chief.
Yeah.
There's a fire exit across the room from us and immediately to your right. For all you people that couldn't make it this evening, this will be edited and recorded.
I took everything out. Yep. I won't read it tonight.
Just read it.
I'll say it. I'll say it. I know it.
All right.
I'll say it. Good evening and welcome to the Monday, June 6th meeting of the Board of Selectmen. Could you all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The following meeting is being recorded and broadcast through our local cable access channels on Comcast and Verizon Fios. It's also played on our website, tingsboroughma.gov. In case of emergency, we have a door to our left and an exit along the back wall. Could I ask the board to introduce themselves, starting from my left?
Good evening, Steve Narco.
Good evening, Bill Gramer.
Good evening, Rick Rowe.
Greetings, Bob Jackson.
Good evening, Kurt Bellavance, Town Administrator.
Good evening, Matt Hanson, Assistant Town Administrator.
Okay, thank you. And Selectman Corey Lambert is not with us this evening. So first, can I have Selectman Jackson read the agenda, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The meeting will be opening up at approximately 6:10 p.m. The second item on the agenda tonight is a board reorganization, followed by meeting minutes. Citizens in business time, we have several items listed under new business. We have Flint's Corner Sewer, media studio update from Stephen Brogan, conservation restriction for Charles George, billboard advertising guidelines, annual appointments review, Board of Selectmen schedule for FY17. Under old business, we have several items listed also for this evening. Modular classrooms, raising of structures, community choice power supply, review aggregation plan, contract authorization for Muskupic Trail roadway and drainage, roadway summer program and plans, Five Industrial Way, extension of time. That'll be interesting. I always wanted to know how to extend time. Special town meeting, First Parish Meeting House funding, correspondence, review of weekly warrants, followed by town administrators' reports with the usual items, selectmen's reports, and we are having executive session tonight.
Yes.
We are having executive session tonight. We will go into that at that point in time, only to come out to adjourn. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. So first on the agenda, we have the board reorganization. I'll entertain a motion for chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate Selectman Grammer for the chairmanship.
Second.
Do we have any other motions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Oppose? Abstain? And that carries 4-0. I'll entertain a motion for vice chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate Selectman Jackson for position of vice chairman.
Second.
Any other nominations? All those in favor?
Aye.
Oppose? Abstain? And that carries 4-0. Entertain a motion for clerk.
Mr. Chairman, or I guess Mr. Former Chairman at this point in time, I'd like to nominate Selectman Rowe for the prestigious position of clerk.
Second.
Any other nominations? All those in favor?
Aye.
Oppose, abstain, and that carries 4-0. We'll take a 2-minute recess while we reorganize the chairs and we'll get right back. Thank you.
Okay, welcome back to the Board of Selectmen meeting. Next up on our agenda are number three, meeting minutes for Monday, May 16th.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion that we accept the regular session meeting minutes for review and approval for Monday, May 16th, 2016.
Second.
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 Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0. Next up on our...
There's a cheat sheet.
Ooh, I get a cheat sheet. Next up on our agenda, we're going to take an item out of order. We're going to go to item 6A, the modular classroom issue. And Mr. Superintendent?
Good evening.
Evening.
Congratulations to all on your reorg.
Thank you.
Do you want me to, you want to do the intro?
No, I can fill in if I need to.
Okay, so many of you may recall that in the capital asset planning discussions in 2014, we had talked about having a facility assessment for the Tinkerville Public Schools, the four buildings that we currently occupy, one which we lease, and as well as the town hall. And at that time, the focus of the assessment was going to center around building securities, the envelope of the securities, the doorways, in this building, as in all of our buildings. We did this spring commission Lavallee and Bresingler as architects. That was done through a public bidding process that Matt and Kurt did with myself, Assistant Superintendent Flanagan, and George Triakis, Director of Facilities. So what we have before you and what was included in your packet is actually a draft of the facilities assessment, and I believe in early July we'll come back with the authors of the comprehensive report and report it out to both boards, the findings, because that in fact will guide your decision making and your prioritizing as we look to maintain the buildings. Specific to tonight, we're going to talk about the modular classrooms. We stopped occupying the modular classrooms beginning in the winter of 2014 because of leaks that are outlined in this document. And Josh can certainly speak to efforts he's made over the 16 plus years that we've had those built, 15 plus years that we've had those buildings. These buildings were initially purchased in 1999, that we brought them to the site and they were added. At the time, Tinsborough had a junior senior high school and did not have the large elementary school that we currently occupy. So we had six classrooms put in there. In 2014, we actually moved it down to only using four classrooms, and then we had to actually abandon using those classrooms due to the deterioration of the roof. We fully expected the findings of this report to support what we had recommended, is that this structure has outlived its life cycle. And in order for us to, if we were to try to rehab it, it wouldn't be cost effective. As recently as when we did the MSBA assessment of the building itself, when we got the roof and boiler project at Tinsborough High School, they said to us, we will not support any state monies going into that, those structures, because they've outlived their life cycle. We do not use those buildings for classrooms, and in looking at our population growth in the next 5 years in terms of the NEMCOG study, as well as our own current enrollment, we don't see a need for that. And with the potential for a new middle school or that core renovation project that we'll be looking for, that in fact might be able to handle any needs that should arise. So to that end, we're proposing that we take them down, and with our time frame, with school ending, we have a draft document prepared by George and Matt that would allow us to look for public bidding on that. The funding to do this entire project, to take them down, take them off the site, clean it up, and repurpose that, re-landscape it, provide access to the fields in the back that we've just done, to change some of the girls' softball field, would come out of the lease money, which is something that we discussed in terms of in capital asset regarding revolving accounts. The plan for the school is that now that we have a base number in that revolving account of 4 years of lease money, every even year going forward, the school committee will have a sum of monies of about $250,000 to expend. We've identified some capital projects for that, for this summer, but probably the main one would, to me, move swiftly and get the support from the Board of Selectmen. The school committee voted on this at their last meeting, understanding the whole, the quick summary that I gave you. And I didn't know, Matt or George, if you wanted to speak to any of the facility itself or the process by which we did that, or answer any questions therefore.
Nothing at the moment for me unless they have questions. I think that was the perfect summary, so.
Well, it's a short window, as you all know, in the summer for us to get things done and to get things prepared to open up in the end of August. So we've done some of the legwork, you know, prior to this meeting to see if we can just get the ball rolling once we got approval from the school committee and Board of Selectmen. So we felt like we've done our due diligence to maintain that section of the high school called the modular classrooms for many years. And as Don said, it's outlived its lifespan. It's a wood structure. It's got an EPDM roof. All the nails are popping on the plywood roof. We would have to remove the rubber membrane, remove the plywood, resheet it, take the drywall out that's between the roof sheathing and the drop ceiling. It would have to probably tear some of the flooring up because it's built over dirt with a membrane underneath it, a moisture membrane that's 15 years old. It's probably deteriorated. Mm-hmm. So it's seen its time. It's ready.
Good, thank you.
Okay.
I'm certainly in favor of taking down a building that's not being used anymore in town, so. you might set a record for how fast it's going.
We're ready to go tomorrow.
So my only question is, you mentioned some landscaping to make it look nice. Is that going to be, for the long term, is that going to be more of a permanent gateway to the back, or do you have plans to maybe do something with that in the future?
It would be a gateway to the back so that we could feature the fields that we have there currently and redress that. We do think that an MSBA finding to provide renovations for that middle school might in fact impact that footprint for where the fields are right now. So we wouldn't do much more than just that area that's currently where the buildings are seated, relative to MSBA findings and what they might say to the middle school. Do we need to do something on the fields? This committee has been well aware that we did do a long-range plan to renovate the entire athletic field complex and the roads going around it, as well as to upgrade the auditorium. So we wouldn't go into anything other than beautification of it and you know, taking all the utilities that are there, providing access and walkways down. So.
Open it up to the board. Any comments, questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Yep.
Thank you. Mr. Superintendent, thank you for coming in. Just so that I fully understand, so we have the modular units that are obviously have outlived their useful life, and you have a readily available funding source to be able to manage the takedown and all of the things that you described.
The source itself, 4 years, 5 years ago, we entered into a lease with Valley. At the time, it was Merrimack Education Center, Special Education Collaborative. They provide lease monies to the town. At the time of the warrant that was presented at town meeting, the warrant was specifically written that the lease money, what would we do with it? We take in about $256,000 in lease money from the Valley Collaborative. We maintain that, we pay the utilities for that, we maintain it and we clean it, and we put aside $125,000 to operate that building. We also get 25% of our SRO costs out of that lease. We take the other $125,000, we put it in a revolving account. The long range plan was that $125,000 would handle any immediate needs in that building. And or I had said to the school committee at the time, in 4 years, if we have not expended that money from the lease money, we would have about $500,000. Now, again, we did some green community discovery, George. We did some geothermal planning as we were looking at that. So we expended probably $75,000, $80,000 of that. But we are getting to that $500,000, at which time we've put forward to the school committee that's saying, and take it as this is 2016. You could expend about $250,000 in renovation projects every even year going forward and leave the $250,000 in there for any emergency on needed repairs to the building because you are in fact the landlord. So if electrical problems or plumbing problems should ensue, roof problems, we've had to add air conditioning because of the, it's occupied for the 10 weeks during the summer. It's a special education collaborative. So the long range plan would be, and again, when this comes forward, is the school committee would come forward as part of the capital asset plan, weave that funding into it as part of the capital asset plan with the findings of this report to go forward, including that, as I say, every even year, every second year, a funding source of up to approximately $250,000.
So, Mr. Chairman, so you have a problem, you've identified it, you have a funding source that's readily available to be able to move forward.
Correct.
Fantastic. That makes it real easy to support. Good for you guys for that.
Thank you.
The second question that I have, you had talked about the school enrollment and there's projected declines potentially with school enrollment. And you also had mentioned with the middle school and our need to renovate that. You've talked about that before and you brought that up now. Is there any thoughts with when that renovation does take place to build into that, or is there even a possibility to build into the renovation of the middle school enough space in case the trends change, that in
Absolutely.
5 or 6 or 7 years, all of a sudden, you know, Tingsboro's the place to live and we got more kids and we're not talking about modular units going right back in there again, but we can say, look, we have the space available within this school.
Sure, so what will happen if and when we are chosen for the MSBA project, and as a core project, the accelerator project is centered around boilers, windows, roofs, right?
Correct.
The core project is a comprehensive review. What they could say at that time, looking at your NEMCOG studies, looking at the town build out, a full 100% build out, they could propose that in fact the middle school is not, similar to this, is not worth putting money into that, but they would support like a completely new building or a complete 100% renovation. The reimbursement for that goes up to 72%. So you could be entering into a major altering of the Norris Road campus and the housing of the grades that might shift and change relative to that. That process, that whole feasibility study and assessment involves public hearings, meetings before all of the boards, and then drafting what's the most feasible and affordable project for the town of Tingsboro that would meet its needs going forward. So that would be a very comprehensive proposal that would in fact study those components that you outlined.
That sounds great. Mr. Superintendent, thank you.
Thank you.
Very easy to support from my vantage point.
Great.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I have nothing, Mr. Chair.
No questions.
Okay, good.
Great.
So we need a motion?
Well, the question we came up was we weren't sure whether the because we're disposing of property, whether the selectmen had to support that or not, but we thought we could kill two birds with one stone. One, we could inform the board of what's been going on. Two, if you wanted to vote that way, we would be safe and cover that they were disposing of that building.
Entertain a motion to support the school departments.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank
opposed?
You so much.
Thank you.
4-0-0.
Thank you.
Thanks,
thank you.
I'll talk to you.
Sounds good.
All right. Yeah, now some work by you guys. Thanks again.
Thank you. Next up on the agenda, we're going to take out of turn item number 5C, the conservation restriction for the Charles George property. Our conservation director, Mr. Morrow. Floor is yours.
Good evening. Presented before you, endorsed by the Conservation Commission, is a proposed conservation restriction for a 15-acre parcel, maps of which I had given to you gentlemen prior to the meeting commencement, for a piece of land situated between east of Route 3 and adjacent to the Notre Dame Academy leading into the end of Flint's Pond. The property in question is a mostly forested parcel of land. It's a mixed deciduous evergreen forested area with several variety of oaks, white pine, naturally occurring shrubs like high bush blueberry, and there is some understory regeneration of younger trees actually happening on the property. From the looks of the analysis based on the forester that did the baseline study for the conservation restriction, it appears that it's been greater than 30 years since any timber activity has taken place on that parcel. That parcel is not part of a landfill. It doesn't have any of the landfill material under it. It is essentially an untouched forested area. There is an old road going through it, like an old cart path going through it, which makes it easily accessible as far as, you know, foot traffic. Essentially, the conservation restriction would allow for the usual, what you would get on open space, passive recreational activities such as hiking, horseback riding, cross-country skiing, and other non-motorized outdoor passive recreational activities that don't alter the landscape. Vegetation management, which would mean any forest management practices that would be necessary in order to keep the forest healthy. Any removal of nuisance and non-nuisance invasive species, wildlife habitat improvement, which would have to be permitted by the Division of Fish and Wildlife, and any archaeological happenings that, you know, if somebody discovers something and it calls for an archaeological dig. Trails to be marked and for the clearing of, you know, small amounts of area for trails. Some signage if we need trail signage, and any other types of rights granted under this. This is just an including but not limited to. That would include, you know, for passive recreational activities. The prohibited acts are construction of any permanent facilities, tennis courts, landing strips, mobile homes, swimming pools, asphalt or concrete pavement, signs, fence, billboards, mining, excavating, storage of refuse, cutting, and that's just including but not limited to. It's your typical conservation restriction. It was the last part of Charles George's compliance with the court order handed down in the court battle between Charles George and EPA that the judge ordered this to be done. It was to be done either with a conservation restriction or a donation. The Conservation Commission elected to keep it with the landowner and do a conservation restriction. Even though it's an untouched forest area and it wasn't part of the landfill, just the nature of the history said to the CONCOM, let's just do a restriction and they can still own the liability. This would be a perpetual restriction, by the way. It's the same Article 97 protection as we had discussed in previous meetings on other parcels of land. So it would be permanently protected. Now, my understanding is that town council has some suggested changes in wording.
Right, so town council has a few minor changes that haven't been ironed out yet with the council for the Charles George Trust. You'll see this is already signed. So basically, I would recommend approving this contingent upon town council's approval as to form. There's nothing substantive that town council's looking to change as far as uses of the property. It's really just nitpicking a few of the finer details. So if the board would like to move forward tonight, I would just recommend contingent upon town council's final approval as to form, and then once that is ironed out, we can send you an email and let you know when it would be available to sign the actual final version, and we'll likely have the Conservation Commission and the Trust re-sign as well.
Now, this conservation restriction, which is given to the Conservation Commission on behalf of the town of Tyngsborough, we have not only rights to use the property as passive recreation, we have rights of entry with the baseline document that they've prepared for us on the current condition of the property. In other words, we go in every year to inspect, make sure that it's being kept in its current condition and that, or any improved condition, meaning forest management, and that they haven't violated the terms of the restriction, which we can enforce. So it does give us that authority to do so.
Good. Thank you for that explanation.
You're welcome.
Anything further from town administration?
Mr. Chair?
Selectman?
Open
to the board, Selectman?
Thank you. Taxes, have they been paid on this property, and will they continue to be paid, or how does that work?
Well, I don't know about the taxes. I'd have to double check with the treasurer. But the tax liability would go down on the property. There would still be some amount of taxes. It would be small.
But we don't know if, does the administration know if the taxes on this property is current?
I don't know if that particular lot, no.
Okay. Thank you, that's all.
I have.
Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman?
Selectman?
Thank you. The, is this property usable by the general public? Do they have access to it?
There is access off of Route 3A. We are looking at providing a small parking area.
And that sounds great, because that's always the questions I have when we accept property. How do we ever use it? How does anyone know that they can use it? So that's fantastic. And is it property that people would want to go walking on? Is it marshy property or is it dry property? Is it?
The only wetlands on the property is up in the northern corner end that directly abuts the pond itself. Other than that, it's all high, dry hardwood.
So good property for.
Good property for hiking, absolutely.
Enjoy Tingsboro in.
Yes.
That sounds great. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I mean, we also do have some entrance by the Notre Dame property too, because Notre Dame does allow us to use some of their backland as open space too, so.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not surprised by that, Notre Dame not allowing us to have access to anything. They're not a really great neighbor. So, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Selectman?
Mr. Chair, I just want to say thank you for the work that you've done here, and it sounds like a great idea to me.
Okay. On the taxes, I would think that this is not retroactive. It's going forward. So if there's a tax liability on that parcel, it would remain there. This isn't going to change what they owe.
We've been working with the Charles George folks and the Citizens Energy folks to clear up all the back taxes. There's several different parcels, so.
Okay.
Should the motion be, Mr. Chairman? Should the motion be contingent upon that, as well as council's nitpicks, as I heard, being put in, that the back taxes are also.
Not impacted?
Not impacted. Any liability or any things of that nature are not impacted by our vote or any decisions or any actions that this board takes?
I think that would be fine. Someone like to make a motion?
Mr. Chair, and one more question for Mr. Morrow. So this is a joint action taken by the Conservation and the Board of Selectmen? Is that the requirement?
That's correct.
Okay. Yeah, I'll make a motion that the board grant the conservation restriction to Karen George as trustee of Charles George 2007 Irrevocable Trust for the property in question, and contingent on changes from town council and taxes being paid on the property.
Just comment on your motion. Taxes being paid, or that
up to
we
date.
Have no impact on taxes that are owed?
Back taxes be paid up to date.
All right, I have a question on that. Can we condition approval on payment of the taxes?
I'm not sure. I'd have to probably talk with Charles about that one.
And I think Selectman Jackson's point was that our vote wouldn't impact whatever's owed, but I don't know that we can condition it on payment of back taxes. That's my question. If we can, I would be in full support.
Mr. Chairman, perhaps we could caveat our statement with council's, I don't know if approval is the right word, but with his massaging of our message, just to make sure that we don't, you know, vote for the town to lose whatever monies are owed. I think the message is we want back taxes, we want future taxes. We don't want to, by our vote, create a situation that we've bound the town to agree to something that they would not have otherwise done so. So whatever is the correct way to say that is really what I'm looking for.
Mr. Chair, the reason for my motion is that if we're granting a restriction, then we should be starting new, and why grant a restriction if taxes are owed on the property? Maybe they are, maybe they aren't. I don't know. That information's not available to us tonight. But it's strictly, we don't give them a tax break unless their taxes are paid. And that's why I added it in my motion. So
okay.
I'll stand by the motion.
Yeah, that's fine. Is there any time issues with respect to when this needs to be signed and recorded?
Nope.
Okay. All right, so the motion on the floor is to grant the conservation restriction with two conditions. One, town council approves as to form, and second, that all taxes be paid to date.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Before I make my exit, I just wanted to throw in really quick, there's another agenda item you have coming up on the industrial way for the extension. I'm recommending that that be granted. The gentleman that is interested in doing the property has been very diligent in doing his explorations of the property. And I think considering what the town has to gain from it, I think it would be worthwhile, because this gentleman is a very serious buyer, and he is doing an excellent job exploring that property to ensure that, you know, it can be used properly.
Thank you.
You want to take that one out of turn as well while you're here?
Should be quick.
It's up to you guys.
All right. Is anybody opposed to that? Okay. Then why don't, while you're here, Mr. Merrill, why don't we take item 6E, 5 Industrial Way?
Okay.
Five Industrial. Unless Mr. Administrator wants to start us off.
No, just update that we've been working with the high bidder on purchasing the property. He's doing his due diligence. Part of the process is to test the perk at the property, allow him to put a septic system in place. Now is not the best time of the season. His engineer had said that if they could extend some time to allow them to test again late summer, early fall, that would be ideal. They're just asking for about a 50-day extension. The owner is looking, or the future owner is looking to do other work as well and continue on with the process and doing the due diligence. This is just one piece of that that they're asking for, just a delay in order to them to retest the soil.
And I've been present and have been informed about results of their prior testing, which the time of year is making it a little bit difficult, plus the terrain that's involved. They definitely would be better off waiting until conditions are drier. They can get better representative soil samples that way.
Mr. Chair,
any questions
I have
from the board?
I have a motion if there's no questions.
No questions.
Go ahead.
Mr. Chair, I move that the board extend the deadline of obtaining a satisfactory perk test under Section 7F of the PNS for 5 Industrial Way from August 7th, 2016 to September 30th, 2016.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0.
Thank you, gentlemen. I appreciate it.
All right, we're going to go back and resume the agenda with the number 4, citizens and business time. If there's anyone that would like to address the Board of Selectmen on matters of interest to the public. Seeing no one, we'll move on to item 5A, Flint's Corner Sewer. Is that being withdrawn or is that resolved for tonight?
Withdrawn.
Item 5B, Media Studio Update from Mr. Stephen Brogan.
Good evening, gentlemen. How are you? So, I'm very happy to sit before you today and talk to you about the potential future of Tingsboro's PEG Center. As I outlined in the previous memo back on March 24th, I believe it was, we talked about what the PEG Center would need, basically kind of outlined some criteria that the building would have to sort of meet in order to make the PEG Center an equitable location in that building. So what we've done over the last couple months basically is look at 5 different buildings that that the town has that were potential locations that the PEG Center could go to. To make it fair, we basically visited all the buildings, took multiple pictures, rated them on a scale of 1 to 10 on many of the attributes, and then compared some of the other criteria that a PEG Center needs in order to find the best building. So the buildings we looked at were the First Parish, the Tingsboro Middle School, the former Senior Center, the Winslow School, and also the Tingsboro Recreation Center, former American Legion building. In the packet that you should have on your desk there, and I believe you got it electronically as well, there's a few documents in there you can take a look at. If you like paper like I do, you can kind of rifle through those. But there's a map in there with some colored lines. The colored lines are the future town network. And then also there's some satellite photos of each location, and then just a breakdown of each building with a few of the criteria that that I mentioned, the 1 to 5 scale, things we rated stuff on. So basically what we did, I met with a gentleman from Acton Community Access, a gentleman who works for the Colleen Cregan TV studio in Lowell High School, as well as Jason Bulger was here, our town IT administrator, and Paul Welcome, our town building inspection commissioner, was also, he sat in just to give us kind of a little bit of advice in terms of buildings and things, not so much to delve too much into the conversation, but he just wanted to kind of keep us on track as far as the building and construction and those things that, you know, I'm not totally up on. So like I say, basically we deliberated back and forth for about 2 hours on the various buildings and the various aspects of the buildings and which one would be the best. Everybody threw in their 2 cents as far as the different criteria and the pros and cons of each building, because a lot of them, some of them have some major cons and some of them have some major pros to them as well, but we had to weigh that as well to make sure that we had the best building. And not only that, we picked the best building for the PEG Center, but also a building that, one, it'll be stable for the Access Center. It costs a lot of money to build the studio and to put it all together, so if we ever had to take it apart again and do it all over, that's an expense that we have to foresee. As well as the fact that we have to be able to build out the building to suit our needs, so higher ceilings, office space, and so on and so forth. The building needs to contain all of these things in it. So there was quite a bit of discussion on which building to go with. In the end, the best building that we came up with was the Tingsboro Recreation Center. It basically met all of the needs that we could come up with, as well as, if you look at the map, it's on the town network on the first phase of it. If we were to go out to, say, the middle school, or if we were to go out to the senior center, that's kind of on phase two. The senior center is not even on a phase necessarily to get onto that town network, so we had to look at those costs as well. But when we looked at it all, like I said, the Tingsboro Recreation Center came out to be the winner. It really is the best building for us. It would be the least expensive to renovate and to build what we need, at least from guesses anyways, or good estimates, what we could come up with. So basically where we're at now is to answer any questions if you have any, and then to hopefully get your approval and then move forward with the process of finding an architect. And then working with the people that are in there now, the recreation department, to see where they would end up.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
A couple of questions.
Sure.
You mentioned the Tingsboro Middle School as one of the possible locations, and I know that the school committee has expressed an interest in having PEG funds either to establish a studio or upgrade existing studio equipment that they have. So could you talk a little bit about how you explored that option?
Absolutely.
Who you met with, that process in determining that maybe that wasn't the best location?
Sure. So we met with Don Ciampa. He gave us a great tour of all the schools and showed us a couple of locations, actually. One of them we all sort of ruled out because it was a much smaller space. The space that he did have in mind, the major problems with it, or the major con to it, was the fact that the ceiling height was fixed at, I want to say it was 8 feet, and there was no moving it up any more than that. One of the big things for a studio, for the actual production studio part, is having ceiling heights of at least 12 feet. 12 feet sort of like the bare minimum for a studio. And the reason being is because of the fact that the lights and the grid hang down about 3 feet, 3.5 feet from the top of the ceiling. So if you've only got an 8-foot ceiling, you've now only got about 5 feet to walk through, and you got the potential for people whacking their heads. These lights get hot. There's electrical cords and all kinds of other things. So that was sort of one of the big detractors from the school. The other part was the fact that it's on phase two of the town network. So we actually just got approval from the state to get some money for the town network for phase one of it, which PEG is also going to be kicking in funds to get it all the way out to the elementary school. But where the high school sits, that would actually be sort of what we figured as, if you look at the blue line, it's phase two, basically. So it's getting across the bridge and then out to the high school, which is a pretty long run to get out there for one building, and would add a pretty good amount of expense, I'm guessing, just to get it across that bridge. So that was really one of the big detractors for the middle school. It's a good school otherwise, good place to go if you want to build a small studio for the kids, which is actually something I've talked to Don about tonight. Actually, we want to set up a meeting to sort of figure out what their vision and plan is in terms of their media programs. So that is actually in my thinking, is to figure out what they want to do and to outfit a studio for them. We don't necessarily need to put the PEG Center there for them to have a nice studio, though. So we can build them something really great that'll work with what they want to do, and then still have the Peg Center as, you know, say for them, a satellite location. They can bring the kids to it, and they can use a full production studio as opposed to a studio that's been kind of shoehorned into a smaller space to make it work, basically.
Great, thank you. And one other question. I don't know if this is maybe too early in the process, but have you looked at what renovations or upgrades you'll need at the rec center, in particular security, front door, windows?
The building basically would be renovated completely, new doors, you know, probably new windows. It hasn't been renovated in a long time. It needs a new roof, so that would all get redone. Security is, you know, you'd have a new alarm system and all that stuff. So, I mean, yeah, that would be all.
Have you looked at costs on any of that, or?
We haven't looked at cost fixed yet. I mean, we wanted to really bring it to you guys first before we went out to anybody for any kind of bids. So, you know, ballpark, I would say $400,000 to $500,000 to get the building completely renovated and up to snuff. And that might be high. It might be optimistic. I'm not 100% sure on that, though, yet.
Open it up. Anyone have any questions, comments?
Yeah, Mr. Chair. A few questions. Have you... Has there been any discussions with the school about the this location?
About the rec center? Mm-hmm. We sort of off the record talked to Don a little bit, just kind of in the hallway while we actually looked at the other, looked at the space he showed us in the middle school. But there wasn't like a ton of discussion. No, there wasn't a lot. We have had, again, discussions about what they want to do in terms of their plans, what they would like to see in their media studios. And that was one of the things he showed us on the tour, was the two studios that they had going in the elementary and in the middle school, or the high school, excuse me. But yeah, as far as the rec center itself, there wasn't a great deal of discussion with the school department, no.
I would like to see the school be brought in on this process too, the mm-hmm. school committee and the administration too, just to make sure that, you know, what they want to do can be done at this location. We want to make it accessible from the town side and the school side.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to see them be brought in on the process. You mentioned 8-foot ceilings. What would be the plan for the recreation center? Because you need something higher than 8 feet, and they have 8 feet ceilings.
We do. Their ceilings are fixed. Above their tiles are all AC and ventilation ductwork, which would be a huge expense to move. At the rec center, the building needs a new roof to begin with. So the thought was to basically take that half of the building on the upper floor, take the whole roof off and raise the walls so that we'd have a full 12-foot, 13-foot ceiling, and then obviously put a new roof on while we're at it, because the building does need a new one.
So you would, on that whole upper floor, you take that whole roof off and raise it?
If not the whole thing, 3/4 of it, somewhere in there. Yeah, the basically, if you've been in the building, the open area where the opposite from where the bar is, the other side, that whole side of the building, the roof would get raised up to give us the ceiling height that we'd need.
That's all I have for now. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, what would be the associated cost to lift that roof and go up? Even a cathedral, like go up 2 feet, I mean, what would the cost of that be?
Again, I don't have numbers off the top of my head. When we asked the building inspector, he kind of gave us like a ballpark if we were to do the whole building, you know, $400,000 to $500,000 or so to basically complete all the construction.
I mean, you'd have to stack the walls somehow as well, so it's not just replacing a roof structure.
Mm-hmm.
You'd be rebuilding wall structures as well, to even if you were a cathedral or two. That sounds extensive. None of the other buildings that you've picked out here had greater than 8-foot ceilings?
No, they honestly didn't. So the tallest was the Winslow School, and if we, after some discussion, because originally the Winslow, to me, was a great idea. It has the ceiling heights and everything, so 12-foot ceilings already. The problem is, in order to get into the Winslow School, you have to renovate the entire building. You can't just do a piece of it in order to make it able to be occupied. So you're talking $5-6 million at least, and that was by, from what I understand, a couple of years ago, dollars that people had estimates thrown at them. So who knows how much more it is now. So the PEG just can't afford to do that. I mean, we have about $1 million to do the whole process. If we went and got some CPC funds, we'd still need a lot of money to get that building up to the point where we could make it able to be occupied and used. So, but all the other buildings, I mean, so the rec center was 8 feet. The First Parish down in the basement was 7.9 feet. Winslow School, like I said, was 12. The old senior center was an 8-foot ceiling. And then Tingsborough Middle School was an 8.5-foot max That was the highest number we could come up with in that building, so.
Chair, one more. The gross area of the recreation center, you said, is 3,420? Is that the two floors together?
I believe so, yes. Yeah, that was upstairs and downstairs, right, yes.
I find it hard to believe to renovate that for $500,000. Not for the extent of renovations that they're contemplating of making.
Especially if you bring an architect in to design it and prevailing wage, and it's going to be expensive there. It's limited parking there, too.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how many parking spots. I'm going to guess 20 to 25. They do some creative parking around there, but that parking lot really doesn't hold that many, but not to say that it couldn't be extended.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Thank you for coming in. I missed the opportunity the last time you came in to speak and address the board. My apologies for that.
No problem.
Is the plan that if the media studio went there, would the rec department still be using that building, or is this contingent upon them going somewhere else?
Well, so it's contingent definitely upon them moving to another location. And we've had some discussion about where they would like to go. They actually had interest in the First Parish Church. So in the basement of the First Parish Church, they liked that idea. But it would be contingent on them moving, yes.
So is there a place for the rec department to go? And if so, what would be the timetable? I mean, the First Parish, can't say I'm for or against it, but I know that that's, probably a few years away from maybe being useful mm-hmm. internally for a program. And the questions of, do we want a program in there? How does that affect the public access to using a building like that, if there's programs going on in there? I think back to the rec center is a very well-used building, and they seem mm-hmm. There was several years ago, we looked at putting a after-school program, I think, from the school in there, and it was deemed there was no room for it. And it would have been a money maker, but there was no room. So I'm wondering, if there's how much space they need, and mm-hmm. Where would they go to? And how does that fit in with a greater building plan? For $500,000, and I'm sure my building friends up on the board are going to laugh at me, but it seems like for $500K, we could take that existing. I've been in that structure many times, and it seems like we could. It seems pretty decrepit. We could get rid of it, and build a studio there for less than $500K. We wouldn't have to build two stories. We could build a single story thing that's high enough that's mm-hmm. an envelope of what is required. And it seems like all that could be done cheaper than trying to renovate an existing building to meet the needs with all load-bearing walls and other,
right.
other
You're talking about the rec center, where it is, okay.
Just get rid of it and build a new.
That's another option, right, yeah.
That would actually, if you could start from the ground up, do something like that, and they'll probably explain to me why that's a dumb idea, but it just seems like $500K to take a decrepit building and trying to make it somewhat useful. Because one of the other things I think in our town is we're doing the building study mm-hmm. and we're continually kind of moving around and trying to get our feel for building a new police department, a new fire department. And as the chairman pointed out earlier, we are a collector of empty buildings. And what do we do with those buildings in 5 years or 6 years or 7 years from now? Are we going to be wanting to take that studio that we put in there and relocate it to another location
mm-hmm.
so that it's in a different building, maybe a better building or something like that we have, and try to get rid of that property altogether? Because we have talked about at one time actually just selling that property off
mm-hmm.
and getting rid of it and moving the rec center someplace else, not contingent upon your proposal to the studio there. So I'm wondering how all of these things play in that we've talked about for so many years, and they really all need to be. So how mobile is this studio? If you build it there, Can it be relocated?
Anything can be relocated, yeah, but at a cost, obviously. So to move the studio, I'd have to guess it'd probably be somewhere in the $50,000 range or more, just to move it. That's to take it apart and put it back together again. probably a bit more than that, actually, when you figure in engineering costs and other things. But it's not undoable, totally doable. I actually like your idea of destroying the building altogether and starting from scratch. Originally, that was one of the things that I kind of thought would be cool, but then the fact that the building was already there and could be renovated was also a good idea. So I'm honestly pretty fluid on this. I'm willing to go either way as far as like the building itself. The building can be brand new, it can be an old renovated, but moving it, I would say it'd be better to find a spot that you can stick it there and it stays there, because then you don't have to down the road think about moving the building. That was actually one of the things, one of the reasons why we backed off from the school as well, because they're also trying to get money to redo that middle school, that whole section of the middle school. So in 3 or 4 or 5 years, they would actually be booting us out of that space anyways. So that was also one of the detractors from going there, was the fact that, well, all right, well, this isn't exactly a stable home. Now we're going to have to move at some point, find another spot to go while this building is renovated, and then hopefully move into a new space if they consider us for that location. So so stability is nice, definitely.
I'm a big advocate of the studio being built. We have the monies.
Mm-hmm.
We have a funding source. We have a need, and we have a mandate to do it, and I think we need to fulfill it.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to do it creatively is great. I always think about, you know, if we could just do it from the ground up, from scratch,
mm-hmm.
how would we do it? Would we start with renovating a building, or would we just build a new one?
Right.
$500K sounds like a lot to me. We own the property, we're not buying it.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't seem like it should be that much to get rid of a building. You know, to take it down. Not that we've ever tried in our town's history to get rid of a building, but it doesn't seem like it should be that hard to do. And it seems like building a building that's a single floor, single structure, standalone studio that's not trying to be used for anything else,
mm-hmm.
and get rid of that building shouldn't exceed the cost of trying to renovate a building that's inappropriate to use to begin with.
Mm.
It seems like they'd have to at least be comparable costs. Thank you. I do appreciate.
Sure, you're welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chair, just another question for Steve.
Sure.
How big of an area, like, just the studio here? I understand the size of this building, but how big of an area would you need for a studio to work?
Just for the studio itself, or for the entire, so edit suites and all the other things?
I know you want ceiling heights and stuff, so
right,
cameras
yeah.
and stuff like that. So what kind of an area would you need for that?
In terms of square footage, 3,500 to 4,000 square feet is a
overall
square footage. Imagine a reasonable size for a studio is actually something about the size of this room, believe it or not. Ceiling heights could be a hair lower if you needed them to be, but about the square footage of this room, maybe minus a few on the backside, because you got to figure you have not only set and chairs and cameras, but you've also got set pieces and props that all need storage. There's a number of things that actually will fill up a studio. You'd be surprised, it fills up real quick with all kinds of extra pieces.
What I'm alluding to is, you know, the area of the recreation center works, but almost you could build whether you need a 1,200 square foot addition
mm-hmm.
to have your filming and things of that nature, but you still have the storage of the rest of the building for everything else in the control center, but you have
mm-hmm.
a larger room off of it versus pulling 3/4 of a roof off here and everything else. You could, the way it's laid out, and you could build a sizable room off of that and keep the main structure.
Right, true, yeah.
I think the second, I think the basement is level with the back.
It's a walkout.
It's landscape.
It is, yeah, it's a walkout,
yeah,
right.
It's a walkout basement, right,
yeah.
on the back
you
side.
You can always have that, you know, and that, if you built off that side, if it worked with the area, because I know there's a little wetlands out there too, the fact you could have like a mezzanine looking down into that.
Mm-hmm.
Working from the basement and the second floor. Just more ideas than I just.
Sure. No, as far as the final form factor, I'm totally open to the design of it. I mean, I'd like it to look nice, obviously, and make it easily accessible. That was also one of the things. So handicapped accessibility was a big thing. But yeah, no, form factor, I mean, we could build off the side, we could build up, we could build sideways, however we want it to be. You know, whatever is the most cost effective, basically, would make sense. Yeah.
That's what I just didn't know if you needed a 1,200 square foot area just for call it the studio,
mm-hmm.
but the rest of the second floor could be used for, you know, engineering room and everything else,
mm-hmm.
you know, all that,
yeah.
without tearing the building completely apart.
Right.
That's all.
Anything else? So do we need any action tonight, or?
I mean, I just had a couple comments to piggyback. I know the question was brought up regarding the recreation, and I just wanted to mention that I'm actually going to be showing them the First Parish Church, because we tentatively floated this past them that this was what Steve was going to be bringing to the board tonight. So we didn't want them to be surprised. You know, we've been talking to Allison a few times throughout the process that we had some interest in the building. So she talked to them about it. They didn't have any initial negative comments. They were interested in the idea of the First Parish Church, but they wanted to go take a walk through and look at some of the classrooms in the basement there. So just wanted to mention that we're going to be looking at that option with them tomorrow. And I think to what Bob said, the other neat thing about this property, apart from what Steve had said, is it's really the only property we looked at that doesn't need to be shoehorned. If we did it right, depending on what the final form was, and using some engineering funds to do that, it wouldn't necessarily have to be moved at all, where most of the other locations, it was likely some major issue. It's the only property that didn't have a major issue. But the First Parish Church, if we're going to spend money renovating, it likely needs a home of some department or some use. And if it's a good fit, if it ends up being a good fit for recreation, and in the fall, Steve could be going through his planning process. If things look like they were moving forward and you guys like the idea of the rec, his building in the current rec location, that could be a good fit. They could go to the CPC in the fall asking for more money, and the renovations could be taking place sort of at the same time that Steve is doing his planning process. And it could find a use for another building rather than renovating the First Parish Church and not having a use. This would displace somebody but find a new use for it. So we can let you know how the meeting goes tomorrow, and if the recreation does like the First Parish Church, you know, I'll have Allison or myself will write up an email, and we'll let you know a little later in the week how they feel about that option anyways. Just wanted to mention that.
Okay. So we'll put this on for a future agenda item. Great.
More just an update. You're welcome. Thank you.
Next on the agenda, item 5D, the proposed billboard and advertising guidelines.
Great.
Mr. Assistant Town Administrator.
Yes, so you have a slightly revised set of guidelines in front of you. Basically, you'll probably remember in my initial conversations with the board as well as at town meeting, we told everyone in the community that we would have some restrictions as far as what would be advertised. The town would have some control over this. Basically, this document is going to be an appendix on the request for proposals that will put some limits and restrictions on what the advertising company can advertise, basically. These were borrowed from Chelmsford's 2013 RFP. They were reviewed by Kopelman and Page, which is the largest municipal attorney firm in Massachusetts, and then they were also reviewed by our local town council as well. He just had a couple of very minor changes. School children turned to school aged. He added the word electronic cigarettes to the tobacco line, and then there was one paragraph that was slightly out of place, basically. If you haven't got the chance to review them, and just for folks in the community, it limits things like profanity, firearms, tobacco, violence, obscenity, unlawful products or goods and services, endorsements, libelous speech, adult-oriented items, I guess you could say, and alcoholic beverages, for the most part. Those are basically the main items that would be prohibited. So we just wanted to make sure that we had the Board of Selectmen's approval of these guidelines before attaching them to the RFP. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Great, thank you. Any questions from the board?
Mr. Chairman, so these are just pretty much standard descriptions or language that any community would use, typical language that they'd use if they had a billboard?
Yeah, that's my understanding, that they've been reviewed by multiple councils, and they don't see any issues. So.
Very good. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, motion to approve the guidelines regulating town advertising as presented.
Hold off. I just had one question.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Matt.
I was just going to say, if you could just add the word as amended. I have an amended version for you, but that's all.
Sure.
My only comment was on, and I had emailed Matt about this earlier, it prohibits political campaign speech. And I just questioned what was that designed to do. All it says is speech that refers to a specific ballot question, initiative, petition, or referendum, or any candidate for public office. If somebody wanted to pay for an advertisement that they're running for office, or whether it's local, state, national, why would that be prohibited?
Yeah, so we had a brief back and forth about that, and that would be one section that I actually, a question is probably not being necessary, in my opinion anyways, was that I would definitely not mind taking that out. I think the intent of that would be if there's maybe some type of political ad focused on a ballot initiative that may not be very favorable to a lot of people, and it's on the town's billboard, maybe that could reflect poorly on the town, but I think there's probably a slim chance of that happening, especially when there are all the other regulations in place. I know that's one of the things that you mentioned, Mr. Chairman. As long as it's lawful and not obscene or meeting any of the other guidelines, why wouldn't you allow, say, a presidential candidate or Senate candidate or somebody to put their ad on the billboard? And it would give us a little more availability, so advertisers might look at this a little more favorably if we do take that out. So I certainly wouldn't be opposed to that, not that it's my decision, but I think it's a good idea, potentially.
Any further thoughts, having heard that?
Well, Mr. Chairman, so why is it in? Is it, did council add it? Is this standard language that other communities use? How did it find its way into the document to begin with?
This was in the draft that Chelmsford actually did use and released, and the advertising companies, the advertising company that was consulting with Chelmsford did review this, and they didn't find a major, they didn't have any problem with it necessarily, and the town councils didn't have a problem with keeping the language in there. And like I said, I think it was just to, you know, it's the town's, I guess, preference whether you want to allow that. If you think that it could reflect poorly on the town, that you may or may not be in a way supporting any candidate or any particular ballot initiative, because this is on town-owned property, I can see why the town may want to limit that and say we don't want anything political to be posted on here because it's on town land. And I think that's a legitimate argument, so I would support leaving it in, but I think that's the argument.
Mr. Chairman, who's going to be the final arbitrators on the actual content of what does get posted on there? So is, you know, Toyota comes and they want to do Toyota. Does that go to the town administrator and he says, yes, Toyota gets to go on? Or does it come to the Board of Selectmen? Or how does that work? What's the process?
Right. So this will be part of the lease and it's part of the RFP, these guidelines. The town doesn't have to proactively approve any advertisements that's going up, but if there was anyone in town had any type of contention, the Board of Selectmen would have the final say. It's written in basically in black and white in the RFP that the Board of Selectmen have the final say, and they can come to us and appeal, and if you make a decision, they have to remove the ad, I think, within 24 or 48 hours if you say it does not meet these guidelines.
So is it the advertising agency that we're hiring is going to be the one that's going to be monitoring the content of what goes on there based upon the guidelines that we provided?
That's correct.
And the reason why I ask that is a political one. If we have a Board of Selectmen, for instance, or a town administrator or whoever the town governing body is, that would be very favorable to, say, one. We'll pick a presidential, we have presidential elections coming up, that would be favorable to one over the other and say candidate A came to the town and said, I want you advertise on your billboard, and that governing body said, geez, no, I'm sorry, we don't want your kind of advertisements. And then candidate B came and we said, yes, absolutely. As a matter of fact, we're going to be reduced rate to go ahead and do. So just to keep that out of our realm of making, you know, so it's more distant from our ability to control or manage. Maybe we'd want Toyotas to be purchased as opposed to Fords, for instance. There could be a lot of things that might potentially find to be problematic with it being managed too closely. So, you know, I would say if these are proven words for guidance in advertisement companies who have to abide by them to generate the revenue are okay with it, and they find ways to keep that billboard full of advertising and we generate our revenue, I don't know if I'd want to change it as opposed to understanding why it was originally put in there to begin with.
Because
there must be a reason. You wouldn't want to be restrictive unless something happened to create the need to be restrictive.
Yeah, this language was specifically designed for billboards on municipal land, so.
Yeah, so the town would be in a position to enforce these restrictions, but we wouldn't have any upfront say in what went up there. But if we had a complaint from somebody that there was, you know, adult-oriented content or whatever, we'd have the ability to enforce it. So I guess I can see us being put in a position of having to, I guess, be in the middle of political campaign speech. So maybe it's just to stay completely out of it. So I'm happy either way. I just, that was the only item out of all of them that I thought seemed a little bit not to quite the level as all the other stuff of restricting. So any further comments? Okay, entertain a motion.
So motion is that the board approves the guidelines regulating the town advertising as amended.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0.
Thank you.
Next, we have item 5E, annual appointments. Mr. Town Administrator.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In your packages, you have a memorandum in regards to the various boards, commissions, and committees that are up for renewal. It's been broken down into specific terms. So there's a three-year term. We actually have an updated version that shows a two-year term and then a one-year term. I wanted the board to have this, as we have done in the past, just a draft version. We're in the process of making sure we identify everybody and everybody on the list so that we're accurately appointing someone who wants to be appointed. The difference that with the version that we're working on now has to do with the Affordable Housing Trust. Those terms are two-year terms. We have not appointed anybody as of yet. They also have, they would stagger as well, and some of the folks would be appointed for 1 year, and then the following year would be appointed for 2 years, so that we'd have staggered terms. That's the only item that would be looking at, and we've advertised, we've reached out to residents through social media, through the webpage, trying to get people interested in different various positions that we need to be appointed. There are also areas where the Board of Selectmen would appoint members of the board. For example, Capital Asset Management Committee, Government Study, Affordable Housing Trust as well. So there are some positions that would need to be filled and appointed by board members as well. So this is a draft version we're working on, finalizing the information. If there's any questions, I'd be certainly happy to answer those, but we'll have a final version for the board to vote on at the next meeting.
Okay, so we don't need any action tonight on the appointments. With respect to the appointments of selectmen members to committees, we don't have a full board tonight. Any of those, I mean, Capital Asset Committee, they're not meeting currently. We don't have a need to fill those right away.
Correct. Government Study may begin meeting this summer.
Okay.
Again, that would be one that you'd probably want to fill sooner than later.
Does the board have any preference on moving forward on those tonight or waiting until our next meeting?
I'm comfortable moving forward with them tonight.
Okay.
If the board is.
Anyone have interest in Capital Asset Management Committee, Government Study Commission, and the Northern Middlesex Council of Governments representative?
Mr. Chair?
Selectman?
I've been serving on the Northern Middlesex Council of Government for the past 6 years and would like to continue doing so.
I would support that, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Okay, do I have a motion?
A motion to keep Selectman Rowe as the representative of the Northern Middlesex Council of Governments.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I currently sit on the Capital Asset Management Committee, as I believe you do also.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm currently on the Government Study Commission. For continuity purposes, as the Government Study Commission, I think, is probably going to, after almost 2 years or so of work, will probably be winding up their work over this summer and into the fall. I would request respectfully of the board to keep me on the Government Study Commission. In addition,
to that, the Capital Asset Management Committee I've served on it this past year, for the first time after being a very vocal and outspoken against how that committee had been run, and have worked very closely with the town administration, yourself, the other members, and believe that we're moving that committee into the right place, and hopefully soon to turn it over to just the town managers running it and not the board, various board members working on it. So I would also ask my board members to support one of those two positions to keep me on the Capital Asset Management Committee.
Any further comments?
So we have Selectman Jackson interested in one. How about the other position?
So I heard he's interested in staying on the Government Study Commission?
Yes.
And there's one member of the Board of Selectmen for that?
Right. I thought he was also talking about capital asset. Do we want to just handle the Government Study right now?
So a motion on appointing Government Study Commission?
I move that we support Selectman Jackson for the position of the Government Study.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? That carries 4-0-0. And last, the Capital Asset Management Committee. I currently am on that, or was on that committee, with Selectman Jackson. I'd be interested in staying on for, again, purposes of continuity. And I think we made a little bit of progress this year of getting our plan down. So I'd be interested if there's a motion to appoint Selectman Jackson and myself to that committee.
Motion to appoint Selectman Jackson and Selectman Graymer to the Capital Asset Management Committee.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain? That carries 4-0-0. And the other appointments, we'll wait till our next meeting. Is that
we could do
what
that.
You prefer, or do you want us to go forward now?
I'm trying to think what the other, did the Government Study. Northern Middlesex. The two other ones we could do if you wanted was the alternate to the Northern Middlesex Council of Government, which would be the Assistant Town Administrator, and the Parking Clerk, which we've also identified as the Assistant Town Administrator.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0. Thank you to Matt.
I have spoken to Gene about that, about his process and everything, so I feel comfortable with it and keeping some continuity in how he was managing that process. So,
Do we have, Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
Do we have parking violations in Tingsboro?
Yes, apparently. I think the major one is kids parking, parking illegally to go to the quarry. So that's where the police really get a lot of folks. Yes, particularly some out-of-town folks as well. People come from all around. That's the biggest area to get ticketed, I guess. That's what I've been told from police as well as from
Gene. How about the mall?
I haven't heard. That was
Gene's. Yeah, once in a while. Once in a while, they get at the mall as well, but mostly the quarry area. And sometimes I think that they have the town beach too. People may not have a placard in their visor.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
There was also other positions, housing positions or something that you had mentioned. I don't see them on here.
Right, that was as working through the final version, that final version would include a space for the Affordable Housing Trust. So the way the Affordable Housing Trust reads from the town bylaws is that the board would appoint up to five individuals. Those five individuals would have to be residents of Tingsboro, except that you would appoint the town administrator, who did not have to be a resident of the town. It would have to be a Board of Selectmen designee, and then you had at least three at-large members.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
How is that different than the Housing Authority? What's the difference between those positions, the overlap or differences or?
So the Affordable Housing Trust allows the trust to spend money. We have money designated to a housing trust that you could actually get money from community preservation as well to go to the housing trust, but the trust would be responsible for spending that money. They could hire attorneys, they could hire engineers, they could work with nonprofit groups to develop affordable housing. There's a range of different things that they can do in regards to trying to develop affordable housing. It was set up, and I'll use example for town meeting. So a property, somebody wants to donate a property to the town in July. Well, we just had our annual town meeting. They have a purchase and sale. Is the town interested in buying it? It's a reasonable rate. The town wants to buy that. And the only way the town at that point would have to do is they'd have to have a hold of town meeting and go through that whole process. The Affordable Housing Trust has the authority to purchase. They could be able to purchase that property if they wanted. It's through the Board of Selectmen, so the Board of Selectmen. And I'd have to go back and read the language because every housing trust is a little bit different. So it just gives more flexibility to the town in creating this trust to promote affordable housing.
Mr. Chair?
Hang on.
To answer your question.
Yeah, I think, because this all just seems, it seems like we have two organizations that are doing the same thing.
No. So the housing trust, we created an account through town meeting because we have revenue from properties that were sold that are no longer affordable housing. They couldn't sell it as an affordable, so they sold it at a market rate. When they do that, what they sell above the affordable rate, they owe to the town of Tyngsborough. And we've taken that money and we've put it into account. The only way we can expend that money is if we have a housing trust. The housing trust has to expend that money. And so the housing authority is a state organization that we appoint some of the members to, and they manage the affordable housing under the state umbrella. But the housing trust would be a town organization.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
And Selectman, I know you have great knowledge and expertise in this area. So in simpler terms, they're kind of similar missions. Then one's a state organization, one's a town organization,
yeah,
to try to manage and keep affordable housing for residents of Tyngsborough.
I don't see the housing trust as right now as taking on a project that would build affordable housing. What I do see is that in expending money to promote affordable housing, one of the things that we couldn't do, we were trying to keep one of the properties as affordable, but when they do that, when the monitoring agent does that, doesn't offer a real estate commission for the sale of that property. Well, what's going to encourage a realtor to bring one of their customers and purchase one of those properties if they're not going to get a sales commission on that? So we could offer small commissions through the trust of that money in order to keep a unit affordable. So it's small expenditures, nothing major.
So Mr. Chairman, more affordable housing units that were generated, say through like the 40B program of a developer that ended up on the market that could be used to, the town could use monies that were available to help market that, to keep it as an affordable unit, or things like that, whereas the housing authority more trying to build affordable housing or manage affordable housing lots that they were responsible for building through like CPC or CPA funds through the CPC program.
Yes, that's correct.
Beautiful, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anything further? We're done with 5E?
I think so.
Okay. 5F, Board of Selectmen schedule for fiscal year 17.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As we do annually, we set the schedule for the Board of Selectmen meetings. I used last year's schedule, put that together for the board to review and comment on and or vote to set for next year. Once we do that, we'll put those dates onto the calendar along the webpage and update those as we prepare our agendas.
So it looks like we have two meetings a month, and one in July and one in August.
Correct.
Any comments from the board on that schedule?
Mr. Chairman.
Selectman.
I know I'm normally quiet, so I'm going to speak up. I know at the beginning of this portion of the year, we always set the schedules. And it looks good, and then as the year rolls on, we just end up meeting a lot more than this. I'd be an advocate of actually trying to meet less and be more productive during our meetings for board members to allow, it's a tremendous amount of work that goes into choreographing and pulling these meetings together for our town administration. Time that they're not using managing the town and the things, other things that they have responsible for. As we get into budget season, or as someone else's crisis comes on because they missed our meeting and by a day and they send paperwork in and they've got, the board has to make a decision on something because they're going to meet a deadline, it becomes our crisis. And it turns into something that then we add 20 other things to that meeting, and we're here for several more hours on that particular evening in the administration. This schedule in general, I really have no issues with. But I think that a strong front door policy, that this is our meeting schedule, that the different folks within the community that come before us recognize this as our schedule, and that they do their due diligence and do their efforts to make sure that they meet our schedules, that they're not in crisis mode, forcing the town to be operating in crisis mode all the time. I think the less that we actually meet and force our administrative staff and other folks to be pulling together meetings and using their time for that, would be better overall for the town to do that. So just some general observations and comments, having sat here for so many years doing this. Nothing particular with this, but if we actually stuck with this, I just know that we won't. Our 22 meetings turns into, if you go back historically and look, can turn into, you know, the 30s or 40s of meetings that we have in any given year. So a few of them creep in over time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Selectman. One of the thoughts that I had about the schedule as well, and when you said strong front door policy, I would be supportive of, and we could do a written policy that the board could take a look at, and it's posted on our website, and feel free to draft something for us to take a look at. But there ought to be a deadline by which applications need to be in prior to a meeting, so that all of the material is submitted, and if you get it in on time, you can be on the agenda. If you don't, you get bumped to the next agenda. That way the materials are then provided to the board sufficiently in advance so that we could review it. We currently get all our materials on Friday evening, which leaves us two weekend days to take a look at it. And usually it's during work on Monday that we're taking a look at it. So I'm not looking to have you guys work harder or faster, but I think if we simply set the deadlines further back and say, okay, the meeting materials ought to be provided to the board members and the public, you know, by Monday or Wednesday, before the Monday meeting, and back everything up from there. And however much time you feel you need to get everything in and prepared is how you run it. If there is an emergency or something that we need to place on the agenda at the last minute, we can make an exception. But I think someone coming in for a special permit, somebody coming in for something that requires a lot of written material to be put together and provided to us, ought to be submitted by a certain date, and then we ought to have it. I'm finding anyway that by Friday evening isn't enough time to take a look at it. So personally, I'd like to have it, you know, a week ahead. If that bumps things too far back, I could understand. But so those are my thoughts. Any reaction from board members or
No, I mean, certainly the, scrambling on Fridays, and sometimes we've been here till six or seven trying to get everything out and done for the weekend. I think having a deadline set earlier in the week gives you more opportunity to take a look at the information. If there's more questions, maybe we can do some more research in between the time you get the information and preparation for the meeting as well. So then I think that would, most of the stuff on this agenda right now aren't sensitive. There aren't any deadlines associated with those, so these could have easily fit into that schedule without any difficulty. And I think when we receive special permits or liquor licenses and issues like that, which we've been doing, we've been basically telling people, it looks like the selectmen might not meet till July 18th, so we're letting you know now. And so far, we've got a positive response with, okay, as long as we know what the date is, so.
Okay, so maybe you take a look at putting something together, just so that it's posted, so that people understand, attorneys that we see regularly understand, and they can tell their clients, if you want to be on the, you know, October 3rd agenda, this is the deadline that we have to submit the materials.
Yeah, it could maybe, at least for the public, maybe even be something simple, like 1 week before. In Westford, for example, that's what we basically did, was 1 week before. And then if it would be helpful to maybe have us send material when it's ready, ahead of time. I know sometimes we have some material maybe a couple days before, and then we're working on projects that might not be ready till Thursday. But if it made it easier to only have one or two items to review on Friday, because you've already seen the others too, maybe we can talk about if a document's ready, sending it out to you a little earlier. You know, there may likely be some times when we, you know, need to stagger the work and get some things a little later, but we can maybe make efforts to get some.
And I would build in, you know, a week ahead. A week ahead is when the materials are submitted to the town, might not be enough time. Give yourselves a week to process it. So bump them back another week.
Yeah.
Just, you know. Yeah. So, all right. Any further comment on the schedule? So do we need a motion to approve the schedule, or is this acceptable to everybody?
No, we'll put the schedule forward.
All right. We are on to item 6B, Community Choice Power Supply, review our aggregation plan.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Mark Capitone, Colonial Power.
Welcome.
Thank you. Tonight, we're going to talk about community choice aggregation that was passed at town meeting, kind of the next steps, just give everyone a general overview. Currently, the plan is being posted on the website. Matt's put it up there, I think, probably a week or two ago?
Week and a half, yeah.
Week and a half ago. For public comment, it's another one of the steps. But I'm just going to run quickly through aggregation, what it is, what it can do. What it means for the residents and small businesses, and even the large businesses, if there are any, from an energy or an electricity standpoint. So on the first slide, introductions. I'm one of the employees of Colonial Power Group. Another partner in this is Community Paradigm Associates. That's Bernard Lynch. He was the town manager in Chelmsford and then became the city manager at Lowell for many years. He implemented aggregation in the city of Lowell probably 3.5 years ago. So we had reached out to him. He's working with us from an education standpoint and a municipal standpoint as well. Next slide is simply the communities that we're working with. This is who we work with in Massachusetts currently right now. Starting from you know, the largest being the city of Lowell, all the way down to there's some real small communities. There's a city called Florida out west, not sure if anywhere, Ergamont. Those are real small towns out in the Berkshires. Next slide is, what is community choice aggregation? So community choice aggregation is an optional buying group that the town sets up. It's literally set up by the town to bring choice to the consumers that they haven't had for the last few years, especially during the winter time when prices have spiked terribly. So what I want to get this up front, we'll probably have this discussion a couple of times. It's an opt-out aggregation, meaning everyone is in the pool until they opt out. Everyone will receive a mailing, but they'll need to do something to remove themselves. There's never a fee or penalty to leave. It's just a choice that you're bringing them. What you do is you go to the marketplace and says, say to the marketplace, the electricity marketplace I'm talking about, this is the customer base that you're going to have the ability to bid on. If you want to bid on them, supplier XYZ. At the end, all the prices come in, somebody makes a decision, the end user gets a form at the end of it and says, do you want this price? And for how long? So at the end of it, each individual resident will make their choice whether they want to participate in the program or not. If they make no choice, they'll be enrolled in the program. Just want to make sure. The CCA would enter into a supply contract that would be on behalf of all the users. They could decide to be part of it or not. The thing I like about this is you finally have a choice. Currently, we all get stuck on basic service. Every 6 months, the rate change for all of us. You're in National Grid's WCMA load zone. So we're all under, last winter you paid 16 cents a kilowatt hour. This past winter you were paying 13. The good news is relief's on the way. You're paying 8 cents starting with your May meter read. So rates have come down, but you see this huge whipsaw. So lots of our communities have gone out and procured long-term rates, long-term stable rates. Lots of times much lower. So the city of Haver went out this past winter at about 9 cents. Compared to the 13 cents all winter long, they were only paying, I believe it was 9.9. So they're going to be slightly over by a penny, but they were under by 3 cents earlier in the year. Definitely savings in those contracts and stability across the board. So they don't have to worry about when, I don't know if people have electricity as far as electric heat goes, but rates spike in the winter due to a natural gas capacity issue in ISO New England. And people have electric homes, the price shoots up and they're using more than ever, and it's a double whammy for them. Again, I just want to bring that up. Everyone's in, last point in this is just, everyone's automatically enrolled unless they opt out. You can opt out and opt back in, there's never a fee or penalty. That's the thing about aggregation is, kind of you're turning the tables on the supply community. Before, we're used to getting supply contracts from, I'm sure you guys get mailings all the time, just blanketed from Constellation, Con Ed, Dominion, so forth. Now we're gonna say, you're allowed to serve our residents, and these are the terms and conditions. We want these rates for this amount of time with this much green. And given your load profile, they'll all bid because they'd like to get that. You're able to lower their supply costs on the other side because you're bringing so many customers at one time. On the next slide, choice. No longer stuck with just basic service rates. All of us has been, believe it or not, market's been deregulated since 1997. So for the last 15 plus years, we've had the ability to go out and shop in the marketplace. Many of us have not. The bad news is the end resident doesn't have a load profile that will allow you to shop in that marketplace. That's why we get all of these mailings. Believe it or not, 90%+ of the G3 users, big industrial customers, they're already out in competitive supply because they have a load profile that suppliers want to serve. You and I individually, we don't bring that. Collectively, we do. So it's truly a paradigm change. Stability, if the town was looking to stabilize rates, you can do any term you wanted. You can do a 6 month, 12, 18, 24, 36, 5 year, 10 year. It's completely deregulated. It's completely up to what the town decides they're looking for from a term standpoint, as well as from an energy makeup standpoint. Savings, it's one of the goals of these programs is to save customers money on their electricity bills. It's one of the goals. I'm not gonna say that there's always savings. It's one of the goals that we're trying to meet. Meaning we haven't got there yet, but I do believe shortly we have a beat basic service model. Meaning you might always be able to stay underneath basic service and always deliver those savings. The problem with that is that model always creates that every 6 months in the winters, for the next few winters, we're gonna see spikes. Rates go, even this winter won't be as bad as the last three, but over the last three, we've averaged 13.138 cents a kilowatt hour. That's a high price, believe it or not. That plus your T&D, you're normally, that plus National Grid's take, you're right up around, in the wintertime, the exact same price you pay for electricity in Hawaii. And that's an island. So that doesn't feel very good, at least for me. I happen to be in the exact same situation you are. So those scenarios are not warm and fuzzy for me. I do believe that these programs have and will continue to deliver savings and stability. Economic development, right along those lines, if you're able to have a rate in town that's stable and low, lots of people are going to want to come here to create jobs. It's not as expensive as it is next door, and their rates are going up and down every winter. For the big users, they change every 3 months, in and up, up and down. These programs, completely pro-consumer. By that, I mean it's powered by the people for the people. We decide what we're going to put in the contract. I'm going to sit down with whoever the town wants and make a decision. These are the protections. This is what we're going to want. We've been doing this for a while, so we can certainly give you what we've learned along the way, but someone on the board might have an idea and say, oh, geez, you know, we want to make sure that XYZ is protected. Excellent. We'll put it in the contract, and then we'll hold the supplier accountable. So that's what aggregation can do, what that individually, because the supplier doesn't care about our load, if you try to negotiate with them, yeah, that's the best offer we can give you. I'm going to hang up on you. But if you're bringing all the residents of a town, you have a lot more leverage in the marketplace. Professional expertise. That's exactly what we come in, into play here. This is all Colonial Power Group does, is municipal aggregation in Massachusetts. It's our sole focus. It's what we've been doing since 2002. We have the most experience. We have the biggest load. We also have the biggest aggregation. Local oversight, basically, you're going to have ideas that I haven't had. This is what I like about aggregation. And I'm not certain that it's going to happen as quickly, but I happen to be old enough to remember when they deregulated phones, and I have a little thing in my, this is a telephone. I have a, my children say, Dad, why are you calling me on this? I said, well, this is a telephone, and that's what you do on one of these when you were my age. You called on a telephone. But kids don't use it for texts. What I'm trying to get at is, I honestly believe the only reason we have that is we deregulated the telecom industry back in the early 80s. I hope that aggregation and the deregulation of energy can move the energy markets this far. I don't know if we can get there, but it's a long way in a fairly long time. But nonetheless, I think if Ma Bell was still in charge, we'd still be reaching for the phone on the wall. Green power. Don't know what the community thinks about green, wants to do about green, waiting to find out. Meaning, if people want to use local green, there's a solar initiative. The town needs the power and the attributes, or the SRECs or the wind RECs or whatever it is. So if there are projects in town and people want to have green supply or a greener supply, we can build that into a product that they can either opt into or make it the base product. So there's lots of opportunity. And what I mean by that is right now there's probably, with National Grid, you have 50% green or 100% green. And it comes at, a tremendous price increase. But I'm telling you that the city of Lowell, and given their demographic, he was the manager Lynch at the time, decided he wanted to have a carbon neutral product. So he bought Maine Hydro RECs. Now, might not be considered completely green by the greenest of the green, but still it met the goals of the community, and for less than 0.7 of a penny, everyone had 100% green product, backed up by Maine Hydro RECs. So all of those things, and with an aggregation, you can get out in the marketplace and kind of flex your muscle, if you will, given the amount of load that you're bringing to the marketplace. Future opportunities. Don't know if it interests the town, but in the town's plan, it will have, if the town wanted to take some monies for an energy manager's position to fund that, we're doing it in the city of Lowell, Auburn, Haverhill, so that they have someone on staff that deals with not only the aggregation, but town energy issues as well. So it's another one of those things. Again, supporting renewable energy. If there is a town want to support any, I don't know if you have a solar field in town or something of that nature, any of those pet projects, again, the aggregation can buy the energy and the SREC, and we can require the supplier to purchase that. Energy conservation monies. So the part that we're talking about right here is supply, but there is part B, and that's the energy conservation. And the city of Lowell is actually going to probably be the first city to go after those monies. It's quite a large undertaking, but I'm going to take a half step back. every one of us pay almost one full cent on every kilowatt hour we use, about 9.5.0095 right now. That goes into a pool that National Grid has to spend across the distribution company. But that doesn't mean that all the money that's paid for in Tyngsborough gets used in Tyngsborough for, say, energy efficiencies. The Mass Save program, that's what we're talking about here. You could take those monies in-house if you so desired, through an aggregation. You would capture all those monies and then you would have to spend those monies. National Grid is required to take those monies in and spend them, but they don't have to necessarily spend them in every community that they're currently taking the money from. So if you put $1 million in, you get $1 million back out every single year. That's the way it would actually work with an aggregation. The next slide, simply just the steps in aggregation. You've already passed probably the most onerous step. That's just the local acceptance at town meeting. I believe it's going to be on June 20th, after the plan has been hung for 15 days. That plan is just kind of the constitution of the aggregation. Who does what? What are the opt-in and opt-out provisions and so forth and so on? This body would approve that plan. After that happens, there's a meeting with the DOER, the Department of Energy Resources, about a half an hour phone call. Then there's a full filing with the DPU. And after you have that filing with the DPU holds a public hearing, conveniently located in their offices downtown South Station. After that, you get an order out, and once that order came out, then you could test the marketplace. There is never an obligation by the town to do anything. If I brought back pricing at, let's just say, this coming November, seems a little bit aggressive right now, but just say we got through the local and state process for November, it's a possibility. And the basic service price was 9 cents, and I brought back pricing of 14 cents. We're not gonna do anything. Test the market in 2 months, 2 weeks, and if the market in 2 months from then is 8 cents and everyone feels like it's the right time to move and it has the right term, length, color of the energy, everyone's happy, sign off, 30-day opt-out, everyone we get mailed to, and we move forward with the program. Till somebody signs off, there's no adds to staff, no tax dollars, nothing with the program. Again, those last two things, how they proceed, we would, again, Colonial takes all the phone calls, we handle all the opt-outs, we take care of all of that. There is no fallback on the town. The one thing I can tell you from dealing with numerous communities, there's nothing we can do to stop a resident from calling town hall to say, is this a scam? It's very difficult to get out there. It's one of the reasons we work with Mr. Lynch, trying to figure out what's the best way to get out there. We have the best process that we've learned over time, but you will receive some phone calls from people that haven't seen this on TV, got something on. Even if, when they get it in the mail, they say, geez, I wonder if this is for real or not, a simple phone call. And as long as Town Hall knows to forward us the call, we'll take care of it from there. Regular issues of concern. No tax dollars used, opt out at any time. Billing remains the same. So for the end user, we're talking about a single line item change on their National Grid bill. They're still gonna pay National Grid. Let me just run through a little bit of the litany. So let's say the lights go out or there's a problem with the wire or any of those. That's National Grid. All National Grid is a distribution company. They handle the poles and wires. Very similar to Verizon, they're agnostic to who your supplier is. They no longer, by law, can own generation, so they're not in the business. Who's supplying it? National Grid's indifferent to it. But for all the touch points that most residents deal with, this program deals with the electron running through the wire. There's a problem with their bill, they call National Grid. Power goes out, National Grid. For some reason there's an issue with their meter, National Grid. Pay, National Grid. Their payment goes to National Grid, National Grid takes what's theirs, sends on to the supplier what's due to them. It's just that simple. Outage management of the lines, that's all National Grid, and again, it's the exact same electricity that they'd be using otherwise. There's no degradation in the electricity. When you flip on the switch, it's there. What we're talking about here, just so you know, is there's no hard hats or pull. National Grid stays there. This is more of a financial transaction than anything. It's just our ability to use the market far better than National Grid. Currently, National Grid's able to use the marketplace 2 days by law, 2 days out of 212 trading days. We have the whole year to use. We can use all 212 trading days. So it gives us a huge market advantage over them. Education is critical to success. This is the last slide. And some of it, I'm going to look to this board. You know better than I how to educate your consumer. I can tell you exactly how we've done it in other communities and what's worked. In case there's something germane to Tingsboro, I'm happy to incorporate that. But what we have found is once an aggregation contract is signed between the town and the supplier, we bombard. By that we mean put a PSA up on the local cable station like this, as well as in town halls and so forth. Also put an ad in an article in the newspaper, and the mailing goes out. Probably have someone like myself come back out in front of the board to explain what's happening, what's going to be happening. The one thing that we have found just recently, and I don't know, certain communities, it's just not the way they use. So the city of Marlboro used a reverse 911 call to let everyone know to kind of reduce calls at City Hall. Tremendous turnout. Gave them our number. People called our number and opting into the program and so forth right away. Some people say we use our 911 simply for 911 situations. City of Marlboro doesn't feel the exact same way. They used it. I found it to be extremely effective as far as callbacks went. And the last slide is just my contact information. And I'm here to take any questions that anyone might have.
Great. Thank you very much for that presentation. Very well done.
Thank you very much.
You hit a lot of the points that I had questions about, in particular, the whole process of billing. I think that's going to be a big challenge for us to explain to people what's going to change and what's not going to change. I think there's an element of, like you said, people may suspect it's a scam.
Correct, and it does happen.
My first reaction to opt-in versus opt-out was I don't like that at all. I don't, because a lot of people ignore it, they miss it, they think it's a scam and they throw it away, and then suddenly they're going to feel they were trapped into a program. And so that element of, well, I have to opt out, I think is going to have to be explained to people. Number two, I mean, these guys know more than me about the feeling of the residents, I guess, but we have very little participation in our town meeting. We get a few hundred people. We have a Yahoo group an email group that people comment on things going on in town.
Yes.
There's a few hundred people, if that, I think, that regularly participate in that. So I'd really be interested to know how you get the word out, and how have you experienced a backlash on that opt-in or opt-out process?
There are very few. Now, so the law stands on your side. It is the law, and it's the only way to do this program. That still doesn't make people feel good, that feel like it's a reach. Like, oh, here's government overstepping again. From them, the nice thing is a simple phone call that can go on the internet and opt out. It's not a problem. It's not like you're handcuffing them. You're just bringing them a choice they didn't have before. Like I said, every once in a while, I would say I probably have 400,000 customers. I probably receive 5 phone calls from people that have been, and I'm saying upset, wanting to call a DPU. I try to explain to them, but you know when you get that customer, there's no way you're going to explain to them. I said, I can opt you out of the program right now. It's not a problem. And you'll be done. You're right back on basic service. Those people, there's no way to calm them down at that time. I try to give them my name and number and the whole bit. I've never found the perfect pill to calm them down. I can tell you that there's never been an issue with a Colonial aggregation as far as customers are concerned. Whatever the customer wants, I work for you, not for the supplier. They want to opt out of the program, I'm going to make sure they get opted out of the program immediately. So if for any reason, and again, we've had customers call sometimes, and I'll say to them, they're like upset. I said, well, they've actually saved you money. Well, I don't want that. I said, that's perfectly fine. Did you want to send a check back? I'll give it to the town and enroll you back with basic service. Well, no, just put me back on basic service. Okay, that's completely, you're right, you can do that. It's not a problem. You know, overall, when people start to realize, and again, to the end user, I'm saying to you, it is seamless. Other than a single line item change on their bill. Right now, under supplier services, it's for National Grid, it says basic service. That's what it says. It will change. It will say Tingsboro Aggregation slash, let's just say it was Con Edison Solutions. That's the change. They write out one bill to National Grid for the King's ransom that they get, and you send it along. That's it. But everything, every other touch point that the average consumer deals with, it's still National Grid. So unless it had something to do with opting out of the program, there would be no other reason but to call National Grid. I can't think of any reason. Like I said, this program addresses the electron running through the wire, and that, and only that.
Good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions or comments?
Mr. Chair, I have one. How does it work with certain people that have solar panels, or they may have already entered into another program or an agreement?
Absolutely. So anyone that's already on a competitive supplier. Now, you wouldn't be on a competitive supplier if you had a solar arrangement. That's a financial transaction with the distribution company. And I'll get to that in 1 second. Let's just, if they had Viridian or any third-party supplier, they would just be on there. They could always join the program, but they wouldn't be part of the initial group. National Grid delivers to us only the basic service customers as they know them. So if you're on basic service, we would receive all of that and everyone would get a mailing. If that person was with any one of the other third-party suppliers, they wanted to join your program, we'd just ask them to check with their supplier first to make sure there is no fee or penalty to leave their program so that they don't get hit with any fee or penalty before joining yours. There is never a fee or penalty to come or go from any of the town programs we run. So the people that have already made a choice, they stay with their choice. But they're always open to come to your program. Net metering, excellent question. I call it enhanced municipal aggregation. So the knife cuts both ways. Let's just say, and for simple points, the utility always pays basic service. Let's go through both scenarios. So let's just say it was this winter, and the aggregation rate was 9 cents. And the basic service is 13. This winter you paid 13.038. On your bill, you'd be paying the 9 cents for your supply. National Grid would be crediting you 13 cents. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. Great, right? Fantastic. Time out. May comes. You're paying 9 cents for supply, and now they're crediting you only 8 cents because National Grid always credits basic service. So when your rate is below, it's an enhancement because you're paying 9 and getting 13 for the energy produced. Make sense? The exact same thing happens the other way. Again, the customer can always opt out, but it's just enhanced. So I would be paying 9 cents, but National Grid would be crediting my bill for 8 cents for every kilowatt I used. Make sense?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay. Yes. Just wanted to make sure. It's not like a win-win all the time. If you did something long-term. If you did something in 6 months tranches, it could be a win-win all the time. But then you have that, remember, you're going to have this.
Sure, up and down.
That's what happens with.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yep.
Mr. Chairman, I'm good, thank you.
I'm good.
Just a quick question.
Please.
So if somebody is enrolled in the program automatically.
Yes.
And they get a better supply rate because of the buying power of the town, and they get locked in for a year at 10 cents. And National Grid, I suppose there's a way to look this up, they find out that the basic rate is 8. Can they jump out of the program? And then if the 8 cents goes back up to 12, they jump back in at 10? I mean, is this like Verizon and Comcast? You can keep playing the.
It absolutely is. We have very few customers because it's managed here on the town level to try to. We'll do it, but it's absolutely admissible. So just like we said, if we use that 9 cents to less this winter, someone has electric heat, and it's 13 cents, 9 cents, winter. They're gonna save a penny a kilowatt hour, which is fantastic, don't get me, that's great. They opt out of the program, simple phone call. Next winter, just say you did a 2-year rate at that 9, and the rates go back up to 12 cents. I'd like to get back in the program, get right back in the program. No fee or penalty for our program. If they were coming from third-party supply, that private contract, you just have to be careful, because a lot of them come with fees and penalties.
Okay.
But what you're asking is absolutely admissible under our plan.
Okay. And just another financial question. Your company must get paid for their services.
Absolutely.
So, I imagine you take a small...
Per kilowatt hour fee, 0.001. They call it a mill or a tenth of a penny. So I want to make sure I state it clear. Say the rate came in exactly like 9, like I was saying. Everyone in town would pay 9.1 cent a kilowatt hour.
Okay. So the spread between the basic rate and the aggregation rate, if it's a penny, that's still a good deal.
That's correct.
It's not that the penny is lost to...
No. And our fee is fixed. It doesn't make a difference whether the price is 12 cents and we get 6 cents. There's nothing more in it than that tenth of a penny. It's been capped, manager.
Yeah, I mean, when I first read the materials, it was that opt-in, opt-out thing bothered me. I was curious about what's going to happen with National Grid and the bill, so you've explained all that. So I think it's, it sounds attractive. So there's no further comments. What's the next step?
No action. There's no action requirement.
No action tonight.
Okay. No action required.
They'll be coming back on the 20th, though.
And you mentioned a public service announcement. Do you have like a video clip or something that explains this in 3 minutes or less that people can go to and watch? Or
I don't have anything up like on my website to right now. I have done it before for people. If the town wanted, we could certainly do a question and answer. We have frequently asked questions that I can deliver to you, Matt. You could put up on the, that answers all of these questions. Don't have it on video, but if we wanted to do a little show on the local cable, I'm happy to come up and do that as well. I also expect to do some community outreach. We always do, after the contract might be signed, we would come and meet in any place, counseling an agent, and maybe just have a question and answer session so people can get all their questions answered.
Yeah, I think we've had good luck. The last one I can remember, and I don't know that this is as contentious as that would be, but the pipeline issue, we held a forum at the auditorium at the high school, and we had really good attendance, and the pipeline people put on a presentation. So I don't know if it needs to be up there, but I think an opportunity to have a public meeting where people can come to. Mm-hmm. We also videotape them and then replay them online. So
we normally wait until a contract's signed, because then they know it's coming. So a mailing would go out. There's a 30-day before the program starts so people can opt out. Maybe after they've received the mail, we can time it with you, Matt, and just say, okay, we're going to have a meeting after the second week. Now people have had a chance to talk to their neighbors, and they'll come down and ask the questions that they feel are necessary. With still time to opt out before the program ever started.
Right, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Perhaps we can get your presentation also just on our webpage, if it's not already done. Just...
Yeah, we already have a landing page where we started to upload documents, and we're definitely going to put the presentation up there. And one of the reasons we wanted him to come tonight was just to start that community outreach process. And the education process really is just the biggest part of this. I mean, I know I've been through it a couple of times in the manager's office and taking those phone calls, and it is scary, just like you said, for a lot of people at the beginning, where it's an automatic opt-in. But once you explain it to people, I mean, I've handled probably a couple dozen of these phone calls, and almost every one of them, once you say, this is the rate, you can opt out at any time, feel completely comfortable to do that, most of them, almost all of them, end up staying in the program once you have that opportunity to talk to them. And a lot of that will happen a little bit later in the process, but we want to continue doing this right now. We're going to be talking about this again at your next meeting on the 20th. That's when we're going to actually ask for your approval of the plan. We posted the plan online and went to the newspaper that the plan was up on our website. We've only received one comment so far, believe it or not, or one question. It was actually from a resident who some of you may know, Paul Warren, asking about why is the participation opt-in automatically? So I had a long conversation with him, and he had some serious questions. At the end, he's like, oh my God, great, thank you for all this information. I gave him the frequently asked questions. And once he got all the information, he seemed like, you know, very much on board. So we're hoping that the more we can talk to people, the more people will come around. So anything we can do, any advice you have to reach out to people, we'll definitely invite them for a forum.
And the only thing I would say is, it can be a long process at the state. So early on, we used to get all that education out front. We find that the public's attention span is a little shorter than we originally imagined. So once it's imminent and there's been a contract signed, it's best to bombard at that time. It's how we feel. That's how we've got the best results anyway so far. I'm not that we're adverse to meeting, you know, beforehand. It's just you never know how long the ruling is going to take at the state. It's kind of out of our hands at that time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All set? Nothing further? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming tonight.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Our next item on the agenda is 6C, contract authorization for Muscupic Trail Roadway and Drainage. Mr. Town Administrator.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just wanted to let the board know that we did receive on May 19th bids in regards to the roadway and drainage rehabilitation of Muscupic Trail. This has been an ongoing project back since February of 2015. We've got the roadway accepted. There's some final documents we're recording. Working with Charles Rules on that. But we did go out to bid. Unfortunately, we did only receive one bid for the roadway project. That bid came in. It was a little higher than what we had expected. But working with the company that submitted the bid, we've started to negotiate some of the cost down on that. Typically, through the 30B process, we're allowed to negotiate down and never up. We're looking at as we go through the contract, sort of with a fine-tooth comb, we've identified some of their costing wasn't accurate. So we're working with them on finalizing that contract, but I would look to the board to vote to authorize me to enter into that contract so we can move forward with the Muscupic Trail project.
Any comments, questions?
Nice job.
When it's done.
Good. I'll entertain a motion.
Ribbon cutting on a road.
Motion to authorize the town administrator enter into the contract for Muscupic Trail.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? That carries 4-0-0. Item 6F, special town meeting, D. First Parish Meeting House funding.
D.
D.
I'm sorry?
6D.
D, yep.
Well, no, we just did D.
That was C.
You said 6C, contract authorization of Muscupic Trail. Now we're on 6D, roadway summer programs and
plans. Oh, I'm sorry. I had that scratched off for some reason. It was E we did already. Okay. 6D, roadway summer programs and plans.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. What I've done is the board knows, as we're familiar with, is Chapter 90 money. And what we've been doing is putting a list together in the past years. I've taken that list, worked with Jim Hustins on updating that, and trying to look at what roadway projects we can get accomplished. There's over $1 million right now in the Chapter 90 funding piece, approximately $1.15 million. What we'd like to do is start moving forward with repairing roads. So there are several different approaches that we could do with roadway repair. Many of the engineering firms that I've talked to and that Jim has talked to talk about maintaining the roads that are in pretty good shape, and then just identifying some of the roads that really need major repair and handling those one at a time. What Jim and I liked to do is do some, obviously some maintenance, which mostly is crack sealing, dealing with that on an annual basis so that we, as cracks start to appear in roadways, we address those right away. But we'd also like to manage some of the roads that need some rehabilitation. The board may be or may not be familiar with Hillcrest Drive. It's in pretty bad shape. We actually received a video clip from a resident there. It was pretty bad shape. And so we had talked to
Jim and I had talked and went out there to take a look at repairing that road and basically doing a reconstruction of that roadway. We reached out to Brock's Industry, who we have under contract right now, that did a lot of the roadway work last year. We're allowed to amend that contract by up to 25%. So we've identified some additional funding there through that contract piece that we could do this roadway project using Chapter 90 money, of course. And then we've gone through other roadways where some of them would need what's called milling and overlay. So you commonly see that as they'd go and grind a few inches off the top of the road, and then they'd patch it, and then they'd replace it with a new new surface. That's one way, and then also just putting a new coat, a top coat on top of the roadways. So they're all different approaches, and what we'd like to do is sort of address pieces of those. So we're not just doing one, the crack sealing, we're not just doing one rehabilitation, but we're doing a mixture of those projects. And what we've done is identified many roads here, probably 30 to 40 roads that are probably the top of the list that we'd like to see moving forward and start to repairing. This list that I've provided you is fluid, so that I've identified fiscal years, but some of these may overlap. Some may not get done in one year, but may get done another year, or one identified for next year may get bumped up to this year, depending as how we move through the through bidding out, through using the Chapter 90 money and so forth. So, but I wanted to get bring this to the board's attention. I'm not sure when it was the last time we had actually identified roads, talked about the roads and so forth, but I was looking for the board to just become familiar with what we're doing, and if it's necessary to authorize me to work with Jim Hustins to continue to make the roadway improvements and use the Chapter 90 money to address the needs throughout town. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Great, thank you. And it's nice to see it in a list like this, so that we have a sense of what roads are next, I guess. And you mentioned it's fluid, so is this sort of in order of priority and doing what you can this year, what you can next year, but you can move roads around?
And one of the priorities is to do crack sealing, so we always want to try to do some crack sealing each year. The other priority really was Hillcrest Drive and trying to repair that. It was in such bad condition, and making sure that that was done at a reasonable cost, as well as Parham, which is in that area. We'd like to try to look at small areas, so we're not, for example, paving Dunstable Road and then the following year we're out on Lawndale. So we want to try to keep groups of roads together. So we'll identify, for example, the Robin Street Rock Road area is one that we'd like to target next. Start doing that. That's a group of roads that need some repair as well. And then as you go through some of them that are listed, it doesn't really show up as well on this version, but they are sort of color-coded, where they have groups of streets that we'd like to address. So you don't want to have one street done and then your neighbor next door doesn't have his street or her street done. You try to do them in the same time so that you're, plus it's a cost savings when we have the equipment out there and the contractors out there working in one small area instead of going from the other side of town to the other side of town.
Great, thank you. Any questions, comments?
Couple of both. The first one for the town administrator. So for Miskupic, we authorize you to enter into a contract to expend funds and do work. Do we need to do that with this plan here, so that you and the highway superintendent and the folks who are involved with it? I know town meetings accepted and expended the funds, and you're gonna need to enter into a contract, I'm assuming, with the whoever is gonna be replacing the current company from last year. Do we need just to vote on that tonight so that we can just keep on moving with this plan? I mean, you have a good plan, I'm assuming, laid out. Do we need to vote on just authorizing you guys to just keep moving and sign contracts or do whatever?
Well, for example, what we'd like to do, so the Bronx Industry, we had signed a contract last year. We're allowed to amend that up to 25%, so we can go forward and have them start moving forward within that 25% gap. Same with Muscupic Trail. So if we hire PJ Keating to do that work, we can go up to 25% to modify that and do another road. I think if we ended up going out to bid to hire another company to do, say, Long Pond Road at $106,000, we would need to come back and have you authorize us to enter into that contract as a separate piece.
Are we not going to go out and bid multiple groups of these roads? I mean, we have a large amount of money and an expectation from the community to start paving the roads. Why they voted 2 years ago to add nearly $2 million into the coffers to pave roads. So I guess my question is I'm trying to understand how this board can be as unencumbered upon the process as possible to authorize you guys, the administrators, to simply act on this plan that you brought before us and get the roads paved with the money that we have and get going.
What we can do is have the board, if we go out to bid and we have a contract bid, say, for example, just quickly, $100 a foot for a roadway, and then we have up to, and we could list an amount, $1 million. So we can go out and have that company, identify that company, and then have them on contract, and they would basically finish that over the next 2 or 3 years and have that done. Typically, with the highway department, we'll do crack sealing will be a separate bid, buying asphalt will be a separate bid, and we have that in hand already, and then we can extend those up to 3 years. So that's something that we'd look forward to doing with these so that we can basically have one contractor in place and then we'll go forward and start to just address as many roads as we can.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
How do we make that happen? Do we need the board to vote on that to do that, or are you just going to go do that and then we're going to come back and approve it later? What I'm trying to do is to get our roads done with the money that we have and to allow you guys to do your craft without us interfering with it. Because I would have to believe that this board would be supportive of our roads being fixed with the monies that we have that the experts in our community have identified as the ones that need to be done.
I'll just chime in. I mean, I think part of the issue may be the form of town government that we have. I mean, I don't know what the town administration can just go out and sign contracts on unless we authorize it. So,
and that's what I'm asking. Can we authorize him to do that?
I don't think we can without a bid in. There's nothing to be authorized. These are estimates, right?
Right.
So I'm happy to authorize him, but there's got to be something concrete that we're voting on. I would, you know, if you need authority to sign a contract, then, you know, I think you have to put it in front of the board. If you don't, by all means.
Just let us know when you did it so we can.
I think that the best approach would be similar to what we did with Brock's last year where we had them, I mean, it was well over $1 million for them, identified several roads. They were able to do more than that based on their per cost, per price for asphalt and so forth. So we'd like to do something basically similar to that and then come back to the board and we'll have somebody in place at a good rate and we'll have them plow through these projects over the next couple of years.
So, perfect. Mr. Chairman, then is that the process that's going to happen then? So at our next meeting in 2 weeks from now, we'll have bids coming in, or is it going to be 4 weeks or 8 weeks, or is it the typical government thing that sometime in September, October, when we've met all the government hurdles, that we can agree to do the paving or the roads the following year, and we miss this whole season of paving our roads?
No, we have people already, so you gave me the authorization for PJ Keating. We'll have them start Muscupic. They can do additional roads under that contract. We have Brock's, which will be doing additional roads under the contract from last year. But we'll come back probably early fall, late summer, and have you vote on another one, and then that'll get us going either the end of this season and then continuing into next season. So it's going to be a continuous cycle.
So will Hillcrest Drive be paved this year?
Yes.
Okay.
That's what they're thinking. They want to know who's right. My street going to get done.
And Makos yes. Is way down.
It'll never happen.
Ohio's not even on there, so.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Would it be a good idea to print this on our on our website, just to have a plan so the residents can know what it looks like, what roads we're going to be doing, not only this year, but next year and the following year?
Yeah, I think, in fact, didn't you mention that already? Didn't you already start?
There's a 20-year plan, should be on the...
There is a list already on the webpage, so we can certainly update that. I think it was done 2013, 2014, so...
I thought there was something recent with the...
Yeah, if we could just keep it up to date.
What was up next, like which roads were coming up next, and maybe the next two or three in the queue?
Yeah, usually we'll do that.
If you're reasonably certain that...
We'll let the residents of that area know, just because of all the construction work, when it's coming up. For example, Muscupic Trail, we'll let them know that, you know, we'll be signing a contract, and we'll get a construction schedule from PJ Keating and let the folks know there. I'm sure they'll be pretty excited about getting that going.
And Mr. Chairman, also, we have 30 or so unaccepted roads in town, and I'm not looking to bring that discussion up right now. But I would like, in the very near future, that we have the discussion as a board for what the plan is to get those roads accepted. My understanding is the assistant town administrator is working diligently with council right now to be able to come up with a plan, and I'm not looking that we discuss that right now, but I think in the very near future, we need to have those discussions as how we get the rest of our roads in this town accepted and move forward with that.
I can give a really, really brief update on that if you'd like. I mean, we have had...
Sure, go ahead.
Acceptable, just a really, we've had one initial meeting with Charles recently to pick up the ball on that again, and I've also had another meeting with the planning department to talk about becoming personally more familiar with the road acceptance process, and then I've talked to them about meeting at least weekly or bi-weekly, maybe throughout the summer, to, I know the low-hanging fruit was really out of the way already, but picking at least a handful of roads that we think we could conceivably get ready by this fall, whether it's a combination of bond money or getting some of the engineering done through a few different processes. So in speaking with the planning department, they think we can at least have a handful of roads done by this fall. Some of the roads that are in the worst to terrible condition on their list, it's definitely going to take some time and some money and a lot of work to get those done, just because the planning board, my understanding is, they have a whole host of requirements in order to accept the road, and if it's not in good condition or it doesn't have good plans, they just simply won't accept it, and it can't get to the next step of this board or town meeting unless it goes through the planning board first. So we do have a few more roads that are in good condition that we are going to try and go after, but I can give you a better update in the next few weeks.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
My apologies. One of the roads we paved last year, Lawndale, I've noted that we've already dug it up, a significant portion of it. I drove on that the other day. A resident had alerted that, wondering when it was going to get fixed, and I thought, my God, we just paved it last fall. I had talked to the town administrator briefly about that to find out who did it, who dug our road up so much, and why they were allowed to do it and why we were unaware of it taking place. It was always my understanding that we had some type of rule or regulation or bylaw that you had to wait at least a year to be able to dig a road up, which certainly we need to make that much longer. If we're going to start investing in our roads, we need to fix that and make that much longer, and we need the fixing of the road once it's dug up to be consistent with the road that they dug up, that the next year it's not sunk and it's a problem. We've all driven on the roads where someone connected to the sewer, the water, something happened that's, for whatever reason, it got dug up. Developments go in, they dig up the roads. It's just you know, we have to watch my language here. It's just unbelievable to me that a year after we finally fixed Lawndale that we dug the road up, and it'll never be right again. And it's going to be a problem forever until we pave that again, and it'll never be in our lifetimes that'll occur. So, you know, I think that there's really got to look at our bylaws or wherever we have that. There's got to be bond money that people put up that can fix the roads 3 or 4 or 5 years out. There's a lot of thought. And every time we talk about this, we always say that it's so overwhelming, we can't possibly tackle that. I think we need to start tackling some of these problems. And the fact that we dug up a road after we spent so much money to fix it after so many years, I just can't imagine what the emergency was that couldn't have been done last fall before we actually fixed the road. But anyways, those things like that need to be addressed. Thank you.
I mean, I've seen 5-year moratoriums in some municipalities.
Mr. Chair.
So, yes.
I mean, since, can we just have an explanation of what the, I mean, I drove by it, saw it, and while we're talking about it, can we have an explanation?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, we ended up, it was a collapsed culvert, so it was town property, the culvert collapsed, and needed to be replaced, so it was just one of those emergency situations that no one was counting on. We're not sure if it was from the work that they were doing out there, and when they repaved Lawndale, because of the heavy equipment, the steamroller, the trucks, the compaction of it. We don't know if that was the cause or not, or it was just that it was, something else had caused the damage, but it was a pretty huge break in the culvert where basically part of the road ended up collapsing, and we had to go out there, patch it up and repair it. The Brock's Industries that we're gonna have start Hillcrest soon, they're gonna be the ones that they're gonna go repair. We're just waiting for them to get out there and get all their equipment out there to repair.
Do you know when that's gonna be?
Probably within the next week or two, so.
It's good, because that's actually a hazard as people try to avoid that. You're going up a hill and it's a blind spot, you got people coming the other way, so it's not a good situation. It should be fixed as soon as possible. And that brings up another issue, is that when we do pave these roads, these culverts have to be checked into and make sure that they're in good condition, because the time to fix those culverts is before we pave the roads and not after them.
All right, now 6F, special town meeting, First Parish Meeting House funding. Mr. Town Administrator.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The town, as the board is familiar, we've been working with the First Parish Meeting House, with CBI, which is the designer hired to put together the plans and specs for the First Parish Meeting House. We went out to bid last month to replace the roof, do the painting, fix the steeples and the columns on the First Parish Meeting House. We received two bids for that, the Olson Company and Mill City. Olson Company was the low bidder at $363,800. They have a very good reputation throughout the Commonwealth and as well as the country. They've done the Capitol, the U.S. Capitol, actually twice. They have a good, as I said, a good reputation. Unfortunately, we were about $74,000 short of what we had available to pay for that contract. It came over a little bit higher than we expected. So in trying to figure out how we could get this project completed this year and not wait another season where the meeting house would be open to additional vandalism or the weather and such, the quickest way to have that done was to request that the Community Preservation Committee grant some additional funding to have that completed. Before I came to the board this evening, I wanted to talk with them first to get an appetite from them and if this was something they would support or not. I did go before the Community Preservation Committee last week. They voted unanimously to support the additional funding for that project. In fact, they actually gave me an additional 15% for any contingencies that came up during the work that was that's proposed. As we had further discussion about the First Parish Meeting House, we had talked about looking at the inside of the building as well, what was the next step. I had talked to them about accessibility and meeting ADA compliance, building code, things like that, that once you start to spend a certain amount of money on a building, you have to start addressing these basic needs. So the Community Preservation Committee had then voted to spend or support an additional $50,000 to start to look at the interior of the First Parish Meeting House, to basically look at plumbing, electrical, mechanical, access, code, and so forth. So it was a successful meeting. The Community Preservation Committee voted to grant an additional, in total, $178,000 to spend on the First Parish Meeting House.
And the biggest part of that was they wanted to make sure that the project got done this year. They didn't want to see the building sitting around for another season in rough shape. So the, in speaking with the Olson Company, they, it takes them a little time to mobilize. We did talk to them, and I told them this was the procedure that I was going to go for. It would take a few weeks, but they said, well, we still have to exchange contracts, getting the information together. They'd have to go out and bond. They'd have to get their equipment mobilized. So they said, looking at the end of June, it's starting the project anyway. So this fit in with their schedule. So the next step would be is coming here before the Board of Selectmen to see if that you would hold a special town meeting for this one particular article. If that was the case and you voted to do that, we'd post a warrant. It would have to be posted within 14 days of that special town meeting. I did speak with the town moderator and the town clerk. The best time frame was June 28th. It was a Tuesday. That they would be both available to host that meeting. And so that gives us plenty of time, or at least a week, to get the warrant completed and posted in the manner that would be sufficient to the Mass General Law. I did attach to the memorandum a draft warrant. I did make a minor change based on town council reviewing that, but the warrant, the draft warrant's prepared here for the board to review. I did reach out to Finance Committee. I have not heard back from them whether they wanted to meet prior to posting the warrant, or as they have done in the past, they may meet the night of special town meeting. That's sort of a quick synopsis of the of what's been going on in the last week. I'd be happy to answer any questions that the board may have.
Thank you. Any questions?
Comment. I'd like to recognize the town administrator's leadership in just getting this done in such a short period of time, from the time the bidding came in to the time of our meeting, to see that there's a shortfall, come up with a solution, knowing that that's such a central and important building to the community, to make it happen. So I'd like to recognize that, and I'd like to thank you, Mr. Town Administrator, for pulling all this information together and making it a vote available for us. We've worked on this for years to try to acquire that building, trying to get monies to be saving the building. It's just been endless hurdles in the fact that we actually can start working on it this summer. And in addition to that, your leadership and foresight to be able to start looking at the inside and doing work with that, it's just commendable, and I just wanted to thank you for that. So just a comment.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair?
Selectman.
I agree. The objective was to get this project done, get it done this summer, and thank you for the work that you did to make this happen. I would further suggest that we might have consider having this special town meeting at the Old Town Hall.
Had you identified a location for the meeting?
We talked about the Old Town Hall. School would be out, but the cost to hire custodians and get that all prepared, that's something that we could probably do in-house and use one of the Board of Selectmen's buildings and showcase that. It's right next door,
right.
So people can take a look at the building and they can see what we've done with the Old Town Hall if they haven't been there already, and walk by the First Parish Meeting House and see what it's going to look like before the change.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great idea, and there's no cost to us to hold a special town meeting like this. It's not something we do very often, but I think for this particular project, it's a great idea, and I echo what the other selectmen said. The other point, just to make for people to understand, is that the bid amount came in higher than expected, but those figures were three years old. So the prices, when originally the CPC authorized the funding, it was based on estimates from 3 years ago. So current numbers came in, they're a little bit higher. This is available CPC money. There's no, you know, tax increase override. We're not borrowing. This is available funding from CPC revenues that have already or come in through this year's budget. So So good, I'll entertain a motion to...
Mr. Chairman, motion that the Board of Selectmen vote to hold a special town meeting at 7:00 PM on Tuesday, June 28th, 2016, at the Old Town Hall.
Second.
Motion and a second, all is in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, that carries 4-0-0.
If you would like to vote to sign the warrant, it's one article. I did make a minor change where it's, the last line says, "For the payment of community preservation projects to be expended by the Board of Selectmen," which would be similar to the existing funds that we're using now to finish that. That's the only line I've changed. If the board wants to vote to sign that warrant, we'll prepare it, and then at the opportunity that the board gets to come in and sign that, we'll have to, a week from now, to post it, so that gives you time to get in, or if you're busy, I'm sure we'll be able to get it out to you as well to get it to be signed. But that would be in place before our next meeting, so it's something that we'd probably want you to do prior to that.
Motion to... Oh, go ahead, I'm sorry, did you have a question?
No, motion on article, proposed article one.
Yes, motion to sign the warrant once prepared.
Do we need to, I'm sorry, do we need to recommend or place it like we usually do with warrants? Do you need just two separate motions?
I think I'll take all the motions we'll be covered.
So a motion to place article one as printed with the amendment of the funds to be expended by the Board of Selectmen?
Yes.
And to recommend it as well?
Two separate motions, I believe.
Okay, so motion to place?
Please.
Second.
Discussion, did you have a question, or, I'm sorry?
You move to place it?
Yes.
Second?
Second.
All right, discussion? All right, motion and second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, that carries 4-0-0.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Motion to recommend the article?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, that carries 4-0-0.
Now we have to vote to sign it.
Yep.
We skipped right over that.
Third motion to sign the warrant.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, that carries 4.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
As long as we're on this topic of the First Parish, gonna interject something for a future meeting for consideration. There's the Adams Barn that's also very close to that building, and we've had lots of discussion over probably about 7 years or so about what to do with that building, whether to fix it, to get rid of it, to turn it into something else. We've had lots of town votes. We've had money voted to appropriate, money taken away. I think we need to get the discussion going as to what to do with that structure and how to do it, and for this board to take some leadership steps. I'm not looking, Mr. Chairman, tonight to have discussion on this, but just we need to do this soon. I know if I showed up as a resident to vote on additional money for the parish, it'd probably be a question I'd ask is what's going on with the barn. So I think we need to start having that discussion as to what we're going to do with the barn. Do we fix it? Do we get rid of it? Do we do something? Whatever that is, what do we do? There's also the parking lot. There's the curb cut where the road used to cut through there that needs to be addressed. It's a state road. There's lighting to be put into that. All kind of a greater picture of our town center, tying in probably with the town, with the business, the town building plan, and all of these things. All of those questions I hear about all the time, what's going to happen with that? I think it's great that we're addressing this building and we're doing a piece of it, but we need to start that whole comprehensive plan and that discussion. And I think the sooner that it's on the agenda, the sooner that we do that, the sooner that we hear the building plan, the results from it, the sooner we get guidance. We talked about getting residents involved with this and subcommittees and groups and all of those things. We've done a lot of talking for a lot of years. I think we need to go to the next step and actually put out a plan or get the right people together to pull together that plan and present that at some point with some kind of deadlines or milestones to talk to the residents that this is what we're going to do.
because I know if I wasn't on this board, that'd be the first question I'd ask when we're asking for more money for the First Parish, what are you going to do about all these other things? So, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
No, thank you for bringing that up. I've been to Old Town Hall for various events, and at every one of them, when we're outside leaving, saying our goodbyes, people ask me, what's going on with the barn? And I repeat the history of the funding and the taking away of the funding and all of that, and so it's just sitting in limbo. So I completely support coming up with a plan. I have some thoughts. We won't get into it tonight, but definitely something to think about, and I'll make sure that it's brought back before this board as an agenda item for discussion in the very near future. Okay, moving on, number 7, correspondence.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we accept the correspondence in our package today, including the 189th General Court of Commonwealth of Massachusetts actions for H-3641. Is that the open, is that the?
Yes, it is. The town administrator signing off on warrants.
Town administrator signing off on warrants. Other.
That was approved?
Yes. Other is a Dickin Lane's residence on tree clearing for Tingsboro Sports Center. Resident letter from the Bridgeview condo sewer tie-in. Resident thank you to the police chief. Legislator passes strict public records law. School committee meeting agenda. Board of Fire Engineers meeting minutes. Xfinity channel changes. Barbecue. Integrated Smoky Bones, and that was from the ABCC Finance Committee. Reorganization, Tennessee Gas Line, Northeast Direct Project, Town Administrator, employee appointment of position, Town Administrator, employee appointment of position, a second position. Council on Aging newsletter, Verizon PEG Fund, Verizon program change and rate increase. We also have a letter from the Commonwealth on a grant.
Yes.
And Mr. Chair, the town was awarded $34,727.36 grant through the Community Compact Cabinets Information Technology Grant Program. The competition for $2 million of available funding was intense. More than 100 eligible municipalities applying for grants, totaling more than $16 million. Your application was chosen because it clearly met the overachieving goal of driving innovation and transformation at the local level via investment technology. So it's a nice grant, and congratulations to the administration from achieving that grant. And we have paperwork that's due on by the 24th.
Yes.
Great news.
All right, thank you. I have a motion, second for discussion.
Oh, you need a second?
Oh, second.
I thought we were going to call a motion and a second.
My apologies.
Any discussion on the correspondence? No? All right, motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain. That carries 4-0-0. Review of weekly warrants, Mr. Town Administrator.
Yes, thank you. The for the date of May 30th, there are two warrants. One in the amount of $763,702.13. That was a vendor payment. One in the amount of $893,776.61. That was payroll. We have six for today, June 6th. One in the amount of $8,041.79. That's veterans payments. One in the amount of $510,721.46. That was the Phase 1 West, that sewer project. Another in the amount of $20,709.04. That's a vendor payment on sewer. What we've started to do is break out sewer payments so they'd have their own warrant as opposed to town and school. So we can identify that more easily. The next one is in the amount of $69,944.11. That was the MSBA school project, completing that project. One is in the amount of $372,116.04. That was a school vendor payment.
and one in the amount of $501,286.99. That was a town vendor payment. That's it.
Great, thank you. Town Administrator's report.
Yes, thank you. Response to Selectman's request, I was going to mention that we did the situation with Lawndale and the collapsed culvert. We did talk about that. The budget, I wanted to bring up the meeting with the school department and the finance committee later this week to start to put together a schedule for next year. There was some feedback in regards to just getting everything sort of in a late manner this past year. We want to address that and make sure that doesn't happen again. The next one, departmental information. We are in the process. We're going to start interviewing for the assistant accountant / payroll coordinator this week. We had nearly 60 applications for that position. We've re-advertised for the town accountant position. We started to get additional resumes in for that position. We did advertise for tax collector. We've got several applications, resumes in for that one as well. Sewer department is meeting on Thursday. We're going to get an update, a progress report from Rivoli, who's doing the general contracting work for the sewer project. The farmer's market is going to start this week. It starts on Saturday at 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Then we touched briefly on the building master plan. We're trying to put together a meeting for next week to get together and start to assemble some people to start looking at different town properties and start that process so we can get more information to the board as we move forward on that one. Contracting and procurement, we've discussed that a couple times in the agenda tonight. The grant, we were awarded, that was part of our capital asset. The IT director had put that in to get fiber optics. He did also, he put that on capital asset, but also submitted the grant. We wanted to hold off in hopes that we did get the grant, so we did get that. It's going to connect town hall, highway, fire department, and the police station. So we'll have a secure network throughout the town. We can do that for phone and for computer, which we haven't done in the past. So that'll be a big upgrade. The other one is we're putting all the final paperwork together for the solar project. This last week, the Charles George, or I should say Citizens Energy, put together the amount for the tax title. So the town received a check in the amount of $220,864.23. There's still some, they also paid the current year, so they're up to date on their current taxes for that. Next year, a pilot will kick in, so we'll be receiving the pilot funds. There's also an additional piece of property that's part of it that wasn't part of the DOR submission, but they'll have to complete the taxes on that as well. So we're taking steps to get all of the property back up to par in regards to owing taxes. We did speak with the Charles George representative today, wanted to get some final numbers on what all the back taxes were on the property. And Carrie Colburn-Dyan was putting that together for them as well. I believe, and finally, the special act was approved and signed by the governor on Friday afternoon. You didn't really need to sign the warrants tonight, but I left them out there for you one more time.
You can sign off. Did you get a pen from the governor?
We did.
Did you?
So you won't need to sign any more of those going forward. But I'll still update the board on what was going on and what we have during the weekly warrants, just to so you're informed with that. And that information will be available here anyway. It's public record for you. So. And that's it. Thank you.
Question?
Yeah, I could sense it.
You could feel it. The town accountant position.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that we were going to do interviews for that, or we have been doing interviews for that, or
we held interviews for that in the past. We did offer the position to a candidate. They didn't accept the offer. What we decided to do was go out to advertise one more time. To see if there are any other candidates out there that were interested. We've received, I believe, half a dozen to maybe eight applications or resumes so far. We'll take a look at those, and at some point we'll have to make a decision in regards to how we move forward on that. We can't rely on having an accountant help us out one day a week.
So we have been trying really hard to
Yes.
find an accountant and identify them and hire them into the town. We just can't find anyone who wants to do it.
Correct. Yes, and I've actually reached out to a couple different town managers to talk about their process and accountants, and they all agree that it's a difficult position to fill, and that if you get a good accountant, pay them what they need so you can keep them there. It's a difficult process, and we're trying to get through that, and hopefully some of these new people that have applied will be the right fit.
Do other towns, Mr. Chairman, do other towns have their accountant position encumbered within the union like we do, or are they outside of that process?
Typically, the Mass General Law allows for a handful of specific positions to have contracts with communities. Accountant is one of those. Just for the sense that they have to audit all the different departments in town, including my department, so they sort of need to be separated as a checks and balance system from sort of the other departments in town. So that's probably one of the reasons why most communities don't have the accountant within a union. Certainly, it's something that we continue to look at and have discussions with the union in regards to that.
But we've tried really hard to hire someone and get someone here. We just have been unsuccessful. When we identify a quality candidate, they just don't want to come here.
Correct.
All right. Just wanted to be clear on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Ready for the next item, Selectmen's reports, starting from my left.
I have none, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have a real quick question about grants. I noticed the city of Lowell, you know, there's not a week that goes by that they're not getting money thrown at them from something. I think that I just read a few weeks ago that they're averaging about $90 million a year in grant money, which per capita means we should be getting about $9 million a year, which would just be phenomenal. The other day, they got two fire trucks paid for them at 90%. Through one of the state reps. See, this is just terribly unfair. I'm sure the other communities like us suffer from that too, that the voting blocks get all the money and we get nothing. I'm hoping that we could maybe work as a board to support our administration. And you know, I recognize we're not gonna get $9 million a year and be on par with the city of Lowell, but we should be getting a piece of the pie. We should be getting something. I'm thinking about, we have our fire station and our police station, which is very key, not only to our community, but providing mutual aid to the surrounding communities. You know, it'd be nice maybe if they would step up and, you know, give us a grant to pay for that. Or a lot of things that are coming down the road that's important. You know, we always talk about the Tingsboro Bridge as being that great money that we got. It would be nice to you know, talk about more than that. And you know, I'm not saying we're going to be like Lowell and every week, you know, the millions that are being thrown at us by all the state representatives, but it'd sure be nice to get something. So, and I appreciate all the work you guys do to try and rectify that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Selectman, anything?
I have nothing this evening, thank you.
I have nothing either. So I need a motion to go into executive session, only to come out to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote.
In favor.
In favor.
In favor.
In favor.
All right. In favor. 4-0-0. Thank you and have a good evening.